In the name of the African ancestors who began the march of humankind in the womb of Mother Africa, we ask these ancestors to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. In the name of the African ancestors who began the march of humankind in the womb of Mother Africa and marched down the Nile, laying the foundations for human civilization and culture, we ask these Africans to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. In the name of these African ancestors who built their pyramids and their temples to their God concepts, to their principles, and to their moral values, who left us a legacy of architectural and monumental building unparalleled in the history of the world, we ask these ancestors who built the pyramids, who built the temples, to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. We ask these African ancestors who took this African culture and extended it throughout Africa, building the stone cities of Zimbabwe, building the empires of the Sudan, Ghana, Mali, and Songhai, building the Swahili city-states along the east coast of Africa, and in Christian Africa, asking King Lalibela and giving him the courage to build the 12 churches of Lalibela from the ground down, monuments to the world. We ask these Africans who spread this culture to the Dogon and to the Akan and to the Yoruba and to the Bantango and to the Zulu. We ask these Africans to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. In the name of the Africans who opened up Africa, opened up the Nile Valley to other cultures and other peoples, and they came in and nurtured themselves on the African greatness. First coming in early with the ancient Hebrews, and they synthesized this culture and produced Judaism. Later coming in were the Christians, and they synthesized this culture and produced Christianity. Coming in were also the Greeks, who took the African culture, synthesized it, and produced Greek civilization. And then later, the Prophet Muhammad, and with the Arabs, coming into the Nile Valley, they synthesized the culture and produced Islam. We ask these African ancestors, who as part of their legacy, laid the foundations for Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and Greek civilization, to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. We ask those African ancestors pulled out of Africa, taken to the hells of North America, South America, the Caribbean, maintaining the spirit of African humanity in their hearts and in their minds, and who left us this enormous legacy of struggle. We ask those Africans who resisted enslavement in the villages of Africa, who resisted enslavement in the shores of Africa, who resisted enslavement in those forts and dungeons, who resisted enslavement in the holds of those ships, who resisted enslavement when they arrived on these shores in the New World. We ask these Africans who ran into the highlands of Northeast Brazil and established for 100 years the first free republic in the Americas, the Republic of Palmares, and their last great leader, Zumbi, whose spirit and sacrifice. We ask these Africans who replicated the Brazilian experience and went into the highlands of Jamaica and became the maroon free communities. We ask these Africans who went into the backwoods of the Guyanas and Suriname and created free republic of the Suramaca and the Ajuca. We ask these Africans who went into the backwoods of Georgia and the swamps of Florida and moved with the Seminole Indians and resisted oppression. We ask these Africans who left us a legacy of struggle and resistance, the likes of which no one in the world has, to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. We ask these Africans who created and laid for us a foundation of struggle and resistance that was passed on generation after generation, that was passed on to Harriet Tubman, who fought her way out of enslavement and became a symbol of freedom for all of us. Similarly, Frederick Douglass and hundreds of thousands of others fought their way out of enslavement. We ask those Africans who went with Buckman, Dessalines, to create the greatest revolutionary experience in the history of the world, the Haitian Revolution, leaving us a legacy, the likes of which no one else has had. We ask these Africans to be with us, to strengthen us, and give us a vision for the future. We'll be right back.
Africa ni ahaye Jamaica sa wote kaka se boso kadia ewo Iwe FM.
According to a great high priest of ancient Egypt by the name of Hunefer, H-U-N-E-F-E-R, he wrote a papyrus. It's known as the Papyrus of Hunefer, the paper of Hunefer. He said, we came from the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells, at the foothill of the mountain of the moon. The mountain of the moon, there are two places in Egypt, I mean in Africa, named Mountain of the Moon. One is between Ethiopia and Kenya and Tanganyika, called Kilimanjaro, means Mountain of the Moon. The other is in Uganda, Renzori. It also means Mountain of the Moon. So when you look at it, there's two bodies of water that make up the Nile here. The Nile came down as a body of water from Ethiopia called the Blue Nile. The White Nile is a body of water from Uganda. Both of these bodies of water meet in Khartoum in Sudan. They continue from further north from the south, and they meet another body of water out of the Ethiopian whole island, and that's called the Atbara River. And in Atbara, Sudan, those other two bodies meet. Therefore, from then on to here and to the Mediterranean, which was called the Great Sea, that body of water, the Nile, has been one that paved the highway for a major civilization that started in Central East Africa and reached its zenith in this Nile.
Uncle Jarsaneb. Uncle Jarsaneb, Life, Prosperity, Health. Indamin Edero. Good morning to you. Tanaya Stalin, greetings. Jamba Wote, how you doing? Very, very pleasant morning to you. It is Sunday, March 22, 2015. You're inside of the Africa Forum. It's Running African. Reuniting the African family for development. Blazing new paths towards Africa's rendezvous with destiny. Crafting an African-centered agenda for change and development. Honoring my moral obligation to remember. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to you on the 107s, 107.1, all the way to 107.9. Good morning to you. Welcome to you on the internet at iriefm.net. Thank you so much for joining as usual. And for those who are on the social media, very special welcome to you. You're inside of the Africa Forum. It's Running African. Remember now, we are on the social media at Twitter. At Kabu Ma'at Keru, that's K-A-B-U, Ma'at, M-A-A-T, Keru, K-H-E-R-U, or simply the Africa Forum. We're on Facebook at Kabu Ma'at Keru Williams, or Running African, the IRFM Forum. We're a Tumblr at the bottom line. We're all over the social media. Read my blog. Follow me on Twitter. And let's have a chat on Facebook. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining me inside this special program this morning. We're Africans. We know that. Not because we were born in Africa, but because Africa was born in us. As our brother Higgins reminds us. Very special program this morning, Sunday, March 22. It's tribute to Dr. Ben, Grandmaster Teacher, Egyptologist. From the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells, at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. That's the title of the program this morning. From the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells, at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. From the papyrus of UNEFA. As we continue to seek truth, to learn from the past, to absorb the spirit of human possibility, and to honor our obligation to remember. We're going to be looking back this morning to go forward. Why looking back? Our brother Malcolm X tells us we must recapture our heritage and our identity if we are ever to liberate ourselves from the bonds of white supremacy. We must launch a cultural revolution to unbrainwash an entire people. Culture, he says, is an indispensable weapon in the struggle for freedom. Amilcar Cabral tells us we are not going to eliminate imperialism by shouting insults against it. Our brother says, for us, the best or worst shout against imperialism, whatever its form, is to take up arms and fight. And in West Africa, they have a saying, when your house is burning, it's no use beating the tom-toms. This morning we pay tribute and honor the memory, the work, the legacy, the man, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan. We're going to be doing that with a series of libations, tributes, music, poetry, a recognition of Dr. Yosef A.A. Ben Yochanan. You know by now, we have been talking about it here at IRFM, that Dr. Ben has transcended. Now on his ancestral journey, this morning we honor and pay tribute to our ancestor, Dr. Yosef A.A. Ben Yochanan. We bear witness to his transition into the afterlife and his ancestral journeys on the eve of a solar eclipse into the Ipet Isut. This morning we pause to acknowledge and to remember this great African grandmaster, teacher, and memory keeper. We honor Dr. Ben for his fearless defense of African history and black power. This morning we are honoring Dr. Yasef A.A. Ben-Yakanan. We honor Dr. Ben for his unwavering commitment to the truth, to the facts about Africa and Egypt and Ethiopia and Uganda, but Congo in particular. We pay tribute and honor Dr. Yasef Ben-Yakanan for his dedication to the use of academic scholarship to unearth Egypt and Africa as the beginning of all civilizations. We honor Dr. Yasef Ben-Yakanan this morning. This morning, in this place, at this time, in this space, we honor our ancestor, Dr. Ben, for the steadfast manner in which he led us to our gods. Remember that? A lot of us are able to call our deities by name: Amen-Ra, Ptah, Osar, Oset, Heru, Sekhmet, Maat, Nut, Anubis, Neptet, Khnum, Geb, Shu, because Dr. Ben was, we are. We pause in this moment to venerate our great ancestor with libations, as I said before, and songs and tributes. We honor Dr. Yasef Ben-Yakanan, who tells us that when your God and your Savior look like your master and enslaver, you become the principal agent in your destruction. Gonna be hearing from a few people this morning as we honor Dr. Yasef Ben-Yakanan. Gonna be hearing from our brother Ranuka Rashidi, Dr. Ranuka Rashidi, a student of Dr. Ben, a friend and a brother of Dr. Ben. Gonna be hearing from Professor Leonard Jeffries, very, very close friend and brother of Dr. Ben. Gonna be hearing from Professor Obati Shaka, very close friend of Dr. Ben. Our brother Kwame Pianke as a Hotep Denosut, and we'll hear that shortly. Gonna be hearing later on from Professor James Smalls, a very close friend and brother of Dr. Ben. Gonna be hearing from Imhotep Rahu Kimetba, a student of Dr. Ben. We're going to be doing this in tributes. We're going to be doing this through interviews, through chats, paying tribute and honoring grandmaster teacher, Kimeta physician, Egyptologist, author, civil engineer, African, Ethiopian, Kimetian, Dr. Yasef Ben-Yakanan.
Running Africa, yen ya krono.
Welcome back to the Africa Forum. It's Running African. And we're going to be, as I said before, honoring Dr. Ben with tributes and with libations and songs and dance and you name it. We're going to be honoring and paying tribute to Dr. Ben this morning under the theme, From the Beginning of the Nile, Where God Happy Dwells at the Foothills of the Mountains of the Moon. For those persons who know Dr. Ben, you'll know that this was one of his favorite quotations, one of the places on which he actually developed his thesis in terms of understanding and our own understanding Africa, in terms of understanding Africa as a beginning of a civilization, and taking us not just to Kemet, not just to Egypt, but pointing us to Uganda, to Bakongo. From the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. I'm going to be kicking things off with the Hotep de Nassau by our brother Kwame Pianke. Later on, we'll explain that to you, but for now, this is how we're kicking things off inside of our tribute and honor of Dr. Ben.
Nesut ne ceru, așa renuge sereteru.
Hotep de Nassau, Osar, Kenti, Eminent, Netra, Ea, Abju, Wepawet, Neb, Ta, Jesser. Disemperet, Karu, Te, Henket, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabik, Ankh, Netrin. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Maka.
Hawati en tawi, tem jefa kau, ta pen em awef, mu ef, ta ef, sem ef, menemenet ef nebet, hayet nebet, enenet nebet, chedefuet ef, awet ef haset, semau em san.
A gift given by the Nassau, also known as the Pharaoh, and Osar, foremost of the West, the great Netra of Abju and Wepawet, possessor of the sacred land, given a voice offering of bread and beer, cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, and all things good and pure from the living Netra within, to the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Suit, Osar, Kenti, Eminent, Netra, Ea, Abju, Wepawet, Neb, Ta, Jesser. Disemperet, Karu, Te, Henket, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabik, Ankh, Netrin. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Ma Karu. Gift given by the Nassau, also known as the Pharaoh, and Osar, foremost of the West, the great Netra of Abju and Wepawet, possessor of the sacred land, given a voice offering of bread and beer, cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, and all things good and pure from the living Netra within, to the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep de Nassau, Osar, Kenti, Eminent, Netra, Ea, Abju, Wepawet, Neb, Ta, Jesser. Disemperet, Karu, Te, Henket, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabik, Ankh, Netrin. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Makaru. A gift given by the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh and Osar, foremost of the West, the great Netchim of Abju and Wepawet, possessor of the sacred land, given a voice offering of bread and beer, cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, and all things good and pure from the living Netchim within, to the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Dinasut, Osar, Kenti, Eminent, Netcher, Ea, Abju, Wepawet, Neb, Ta, Jesser, Disemperet, Karu, Te, Henket, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabik, Ankh, Netcherin, NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Ma Karu. Given by the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh and Osar, foremost of the West, the great Netcher of Abju and Wepawet, possessor of the sacred land, given a voice offering of bread and beer, cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, and all things good and pure from the living Netcher within, to the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep Dinasut, Osar, Kenti, Eminent, Netcher, Ea, Abju, Wepawet, Neb, Ta, Jesser, Disemperet, Karu, Te, Henket, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabik, Ankh, Nectarin, NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Ma Karu. A gift given by the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh and Osar, foremost of the West, the great Netcher of Abju and Wepawet, possessor of the sacred land, given a voice offering of bread and beer, cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, and all things good and pure from the living Netcher within, to the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice, true of voice.
Africa. Africa. Running Africa ni. Ahaye Jamaica. Sa wote kaka se eboso kadia. Ewo Ire FM.
Welcome to the program. If you're just joining us, you're inside a special tribute to our now ancestor, Dr. Yusuf Ben Yohanan. From the beginning of a Nile, where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. Bakongo is where Dr. Ben pointed us to, as the area in Uganda where the first city along the Nile was developed. Bundo de Akongo is the music you're listening to. Before that, our brother Kwame Pianke gave a Hotepdena suit in the manner of ancient Egypt, in the manner of ancient Kemet. To come inside of the program, we'll be speaking with Dr. Wunuka Rashidi, Professor Leonard Jeffries, Professor Obati Shaka, Dr. James Smalls, Acknowledging those who are locked in and listening in from across the continent of Africa, from the United States, from Europe, the UK in particular, but all across Europe, from Asia. Thank you for joining us on this very special day as we pay tribute to one of our elders, our grandmaster teacher, Dr. Ben Yakanan. As we told you, going to be doing this by way of libations, by way of tributes, by way of interviews, by way of remembering, recalling, and sankofa-ing. Here now, a mix of libation in the way, the African way, the African tradition, as we pay tribute to Grandmaster Teacher, Dr. Ben Yakanan.
Once again, we as African people are gathered here together. Oh, ancestors.
Ancestors.
Black upon the thousand midnights.
Black upon the thousand midnights.
African ancestors.
African ancestors.
It is you that we, your children, give respect and honor.
It is you that we, your children, give respect and honor.
O ancestors.
O ancestors.
We call upon you.
We call upon you.
And welcome you to this place.
And welcome you to this place.
African ancestors.
African ancestors.
Let your presence fill this place.
Let your presence fill this place.
Oh, African ancestors,
oh, African ancestors,
who have been purposely excluded from the history books,
who have purposely been excluded from the history books,
so that the world would not know of your greatness.
So that the world would not know of your great greatness.
Our African ancestors,
our African ancestors,
who gave civilization to the world,
who gave civilization to the world.
Our African ancestors,
who gave arts to the world.
Our African ancestors,
who gave music to the world.
Our African ancestors,
who gave mathematics to the world.
Our African ancestors, who gave medicine to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave philosophy to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave God consciousness to the world.
Ancestors,
we thank you for devoting your life to make a future for us.
For
your children,
for your grandchildren,
for your great grandchildren,
and for those yet unborn.
Now stand with us,
strengthen us,
guide us,
teach us,
and protect us from the snare of our enemies. Rise up, O African ancestors.
Rise up, O African ancestors.
And let our enemies be scattered.
And let our enemies be scattered.
And give us the wisdom.
And give us the wisdom.
And the boldness.
And the boldness.
To deal with our oppressors.
To deal with our oppressors.
And those who would hinder the liberation.
And those who would hinder the liberation.
And the empowerment of our people.
Empowerment of our people.
Rise up, O African ancestors.
Rise up, O African ancestors.
And live in us.
And live in us.
And we will not fail to honor you.
And we will not fail to honor you.
We will not fail to respect you.
We will not fail to respect you.
We will not fail to hear you.
We will not fail to hear you.
And we will not betray you.
And we will not betray you.
Ashe.
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 Not speak without first asking for permission from the elders. I also humble myself at the honorable mention of those who have fought and or died for the liberation of African people, whether on the continent or in the diaspora. Realizing that at this present moment in time, we need them more than we ever have before. And I am not ashamed of the contributions that they have made. So I call on them.
John Henry Clark, Dr. Ben, Queen Ashantiwa.
If you are not ashamed of what they have done for you, then call on them.
Khalil Muhammad, Malcolm X, Nat Turner.
If you are in need of the power and strength that they possess, then call on them.
Denmark VC, KB. Ashantiwa, Nefertiti, Ashe, Ashe,
finished,
Ashe.
Oh, ancestors, blacker than a thousand midnights, African ancestors, it is to you that we, your children, give respect and honor. Oh, ancestors, we call upon you and welcome you in this place. African ancestors, let your presence fill this place. Oh, ancestors, who have been purposely excluded from the history books so that the world would not know of your greatness. Our African ancestors, who gave civilization to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave the arts to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave music to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave the sciences to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave mathematics to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave medicine to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave literature to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave philosophy to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave God consciousness to the world. Oh, ancestors, we thank you for devoting your life to make a future for us, your children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Now stand with us, strengthen us, guide us, teach us, and protect us from the snare of our enemies. Rise up, O African ancestors, and let our enemies be scattered, and give us the wisdom and the boldness to deal with our oppressors and those who would hinder the liberation and empowerment of our people. Rise up, O African ancestors, and live in us, and we will not fail to honor you. We will not fail to respect you. We will not fail to hear you, and we will not betray you. Ashe.
Yehye Oshun is the spirit of the river. Open your hands, she's a sweet and steady giver. She'll turn your tears of sadness into gladness. Praises to Oshun. Yehye Oshun is the spirit of the river. Open your hands, she's a sweet and steady giver. She'll turn your tears of sadness into gladness. Praises to Oshun. Yeah.
Creator, Ptah, yeah. Oludumare, Odumakoma, Enyame, Ama, Neter, all traditional African names for the one God. Abosun, Orisha, Loa, Neteru, aspects of the divine, Nsamanfo, Sheps, Egongo, ancestors on whose shoulders we stand. Black notes, libation, a spiritual offering, a prayer with props to God, to earth, with water, fire, air, breath of life of the Creator, divine presence, wisdom, pow, connecting us to ancestors, Queen Nzinga, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, Kwame Nkrumah, Patrice Lumumba, Malcolm X, Stephen Biko. Connecting us to ancestors, struggles to progress, past to present, enlightenment to African cultural, spiritual space, gracing the cosmos, the universe with aspects of the all, encompassing our entire being, singing in harmony with joy, in pleasure, beyond measure, in passion for life, voiced like the song of the river, flowing with the sensual grace of Oshun. Oshun, Heheru, Nana Esi, Oshun, representing the beautiful, the feminine features of life, lightly dancing to a timeless rhythm, in tune with the tone of a spiritual offering, a prayer with props to the highest, down to earth with water, fire, air, breath of life of the Creator, divine presence, wisdom, power, like the nucleus, the core, black, sweet, black woman, energy, strength, black man, energy, complementing, black woman, energy, unifying, connecting us to ancestors. Luther King, Queen T, Imhotep, Zumbi, David Walker, Nat Turner, Ida B. Wells, Marcus Garvey, Medgar Evers, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fred Hampton, George Jackson, Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, John Henry Clark, Fela, Anikulapo, Kuti, connecting us to ancestors, struggles to progress, past to present to future. Transcending space and time, ancient to future. Black notes, libation, and pie. A spiritual donation to creation, creatively opening the way. From this day forward for divine melody, presence, rhythm, wisdom, word.
A celebration of the life of Dr. Yosef Ben-Yochanan, who embodied and embodies the very vision of this space, this time, this place in which we are now, which is to reunite the African family for development, whose mission became my mission, my purpose, understanding through Dr. Ben. Because I met Dr. Ben, I understood better my purpose. And this is not a joke. This is pretty serious as we celebrate his life. Understanding that part of my mission was to be part of those who were blazing new paths towards Africa's rendezvous with destiny. That part of my mission was to bear witness, to demand change, to craft an African-centered agenda for change and development, understanding the African worldview, and all the while to honor my moral obligation to remember. Many years ago, 1991, early 91, just a year after IRFM started, we here at IRFM received an invitation from the African Heritage Studies Association, and they'd asked me to be there, be part of the conference. And as a young girl, I went to Chicago and, you know, found myself in the midst of the elders, in the midst of the academic warriors, in the midst of those whose books I was reading and studying, and finding myself through the pages as they took me to Africa. And Dr. Ben Yochanan was one of those persons I met in 1991, early in Chicago, at the University of Chicago. My first interview was with Dr. Ben in Chicago, and we maintained a very close relationship even after I returned to Jamaica. So Dr. Ben was a constant staple on this program. And then later on in 97, I had the opportunity in my new position at IRFM to invite him to Jamaica in February 1997 to be part of our Black History Month celebrations. And that involved him also being our guest lecturer. And then again, we invited Dr. Ben back in early 1998 to be part of the installment of our Queen Mother Mariam Samad. And that we saw in both these occasions, thousands of people turning out to listen to and to hear Dr. Ben. We pay tribute to and we honor Dr. Ben.
Odumakoma, Enyame, Ama, Neter, all traditional African names for the one God. Abosun, Orisha, Loa, Neteru, aspects of the divine, Insamanfo, Sheps, Egongo, ancestors on whose shoulders we stand. Black notes. Libation.
We go live. We go live to the phone lines. Just returning from Vanuatu and from Australia, our brother Dr. Onuka Rashidi, as we pay tribute to, celebrate and honor the life, the works and the legacy of Dr. Yusuf Ben Yochanan. On the phone lines, Dr. Onuka Rashidi. Dr. Rashidi, thank you so much for joining us this morning, just returning from a very long journey across the waters. Thank you so much. In assisting to pay honor and to pay tribute to Dr. Ben this morning.
Well, the honor is mine. Thank you for having me.
All right, Dr. Rashidi, first of all, I know, you know, one of the first things in our conversations myself with you is that you mentioned the extent to which you yourself were a student of Dr. Ben, a friend of Dr. Ben. As a matter of fact, I know a very, very close friend. Talk about that relationship, first of all.
Well, I don't know. I guess I must have become aware of Dr. Ben sometime in the, I guess, mid to early 1970s. And I saw him speak. I guess it must have been about 1980. We had a kind of a tumultuous relationship in the early 1980s. By 1991, our relationship had changed yet again. I've known this man for a very long time. And the relationship has taken on different forms. But around 1991, I felt under a lot of pressure to travel to Egypt. You know, I've been doing lectures, been doing presentations, but people, you know, tended to say, as we will do, but have you been there?
Mm-hmm.
And so I put word out to people that were close to Dr. Ben. And sure enough, in 1991, they arranged for me to travel with him to Egypt as his as an assistant. And I was able to do that on four different occasions in the 1990s. So I went from a point of hearing about this man, to seeing him lecture, to meeting him, you know, to interacting with him in various lecture forums, to actually traveling to Egypt with him. And that really changed the relationship dramatically. It's one thing to see him lecture or to read his books, but it's quite another thing to be in the Valley of the Nile with him, to be in a temple complex. And these are memories that you never forget. I remember once being with a group, again, as his assistant, in a temple of Heheru, Hathor, at a place called Dendera, and him calling me aside, telling the rest of the group to go on, and him calling me aside and walking me through various parts of the temple, just he and I, and telling me, well, this is, this part of the temple had such and such a significance, and talking about his relationship with people like George G.M. James, who wrote the book Stolen Legacy, or his feelings about people like Chancellor Williams, who wrote the book Destruction of Black Civilization. So the relationship continued even after I stopped traveling with him and started traveling independently. We still did a lot of lectures together. I would come to New York particularly, and sometimes he and John Henry Clark would be in the audience, or we'd have a program involving Ivan Van Sertima. And eventually, you know, I began to travel with him, escorting him to various places domestically in the United States, just to look after him and to do lectures with him. And finally, you know, the relationship deteriorated to the point where, you know, he was put in a nursing home and coming to visit him there and hearing him lament and talk about aspects of his life and what it had meant and our relationship with him. So I've known Dr. Ben, I guess, since the 1970s, and it's been very special.
Yes, and as I listen to you talk, and one of the things that we know in the Pan-African and the wider African community is that, in a way, you have taken on that mantle. And I want you to explain to us, because for many, I don't know if we can understand what it is that drives a man to be so committed to the truths, to facts about Africa, and not just to speak commitment, but to do commitment. And I see you doing the very same thing right now. What it is, where does this drive come from that you think propelled Dr. Ben to write these books, to do these tours, to accept these invitations to far-off places, even into when he was much older, just to lecture, and many times for free?
Well, first, I guess two things in particular that stand out the most. One is you have the information. Once you get this information, you're stuck with it. You can't just forget it. You can't suppress it. You can't pretend that you don't know. And I think that that's why a lot of people are afraid of this knowledge, because once you become possessed of knowledge of self, what you going to do? Where do you go from here? What do you do with it? So that's part of it. But at the same time, I think that people like Dr. Ben, like Dr. Clark, myself, I can speak for certainly, but I think these other ancestors too, they loved our people. They loved black people. So on the one hand, you have an extensive knowledge of self, our history, the role that African people have played in terms of contributing towards, in Dr. Ben's case, major world religions. In addition to Kemet, the Nile Valley, which was his focus historically, as you know, he put a lot of emphasis on the African origins of major Western religions, and that made Dr. Ben, in the eyes of many people, very controversial.
Yes.
But he loved black people. And you realize the importance of this information in terms of African liberation. And so when you put those things together, knowledge of self and love for self, love of our community, well, it produces people like Dr. Ben, people that some people would think are crazy or obsessed. But Dr. Ben, in a sense, is no different than Marcus Garvey. Mm-hmm. Marcus Garvey loved our people. He was a great orator. He had tremendous organizational skills. Dr. Ben loved our people, but his direction was his gift was to tell us about who we are and what we did and what we're therefore capable of doing. And then another factor was the way he did it. Dr. Ben, as Malcolm used to say, made it plain. He spoke in a manner that the average person could relate to. He didn't come from an ivory tower kind of perspective. You knew where he was coming from. He spoke in a plain, blunt language. Sometimes you disagreed with him, or you bridled in the manner that he gave the information to. Dr. Ben had a tremendous temper. Dr. Ben, another thing you realize about him, and it comes out of the Nile Valley tradition, is that he was very, very human. Sometimes you didn't like what he had to say, and you saw his humanity, you saw his frailties, his what might be perceived as his faults. But that doesn't mean that that didn't take away from his greatness. I think that he taught us, one of the lessons I got from him, is that it's okay to be a human being. It's okay to not be perfect, but that doesn't make you any less great. So many, many things that we can learn from him in terms of symbolism and also personal.
Right. And as you, and you know,
there's something else I want to add.
So, yes, go ahead.
Now, you pointed out that I just came back from Vanuatu in Australia, which I did, historic journeys. I was there during the hurricane, during the cyclone. Mm. But Dr. Ben is the first person that I'm aware of to talk about the black presence in the Pacific. In the early to mid-1970s, he wrote a multi-volume book, which I'm not sure if it's even in print anymore. I meant to look it up again because I don't have all of his books. He wrote a lot of stuff. But he wrote a multi-volume book called They All Look Alike. And it was about his journeys with black people in Papua New Guinea. So here we're talking about something that almost nobody had ever done before. And that is not just look at black people in Africa, ancient and modern, and not just look at black people who are in the world today as a result of enslavement, but to also look at black people who left Africa thousands of years before slavery, thousands of years before Columbus, and journeyed into the South Pacific. So in many ways, he was really, really, really a pioneer. And I don't know if he gets enough credit for that.
Yes. Good point that you're making there about him being a pioneer, because this is where I wanted to go next with you, Dr. Rashidi, to look at some of what Dr. Ben revealed through his research to us. I started talking boldly about Egypt and about Kemet and Moses and whether Moses existed or not because I read Dr. Ben, because I listened to Dr. Ben, because I met him. And I don't know how much work was done in that regard before Dr. Ben, but he was kind of, you talked about being a pioneer, groundbreaking work from Dr. Ben. What were some of these highlights?
Well, Dr. Ben's major books, like Black Man of the Nile, for example, those to me his first really, really, really big book. Not his first book, but big, big, big book. Book to have an impact. And then he would do books like From Abu Simbel to Giza. But those books began to be published in the mid-1970s. And this, in many ways, was the beginning of kind of a golden age in what I might call African-centered historiography. Sheikh Anta Diop's book, African Origin of Civilization, Myth or Reality, I think was first published in English in 1974. I think Black Man of the Nile must have come out about 1972, 1974, something like that. It wasn't long after that that Ivan Van Sertima, the great Ivan Van Sertima's book that came before Columbus was published. So this was a kind of a renaissance in a sense. This was kind of a new age period. It wasn't the first time African scholars had talked about these sort of things. Early on, you had people like William Leo Hansberry. Destruction of Black Civilization was first published around 1971. So all of these powerful, powerful, powerful pieces are coming out around this particular time.
Yes.
But again, the style of Dr. Ben's stuff, very, very provocative, designed to provoke. He made it clear that Egyptian civilization to another generation, a new generation of our people, was clearly black. Egypt is in Africa. It's always been in Africa. And Dr. Ben emphasized that. But the other part of it is Dr. Ben actually took people to Egypt. So it wasn't enough just to look at pictures of the pyramids or to even see pictures of black people from pharaohs from the ancient Nile Valley, but he took people there so that they could see it for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And you know the old expression is seeing is believing.
Yes.
And then in terms of religion, yes, talking about Christianity, mm-hmm. Judaism, Islam, all rooted in the Nile Valley, that shook a lot of people up. And it clarified to many people who were questioning these things, it gave it a new light.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it shined it under a different kind of microscope, a very powerful microscope. So Dr. Ben, I guess you could say, was one of the great pioneers in what we might call this modern reawakening of the African mind in terms of who we are and what we've done. My philosophy of history is personified by Dr. Ben, and that is what you do for yourself depends on what you think of yourself. And what you think of yourself depends on what you know of yourself. And what you know of yourself depends on what you have been told. So if you're programmed to believe you come from nothing, which is based on a belief that you have no real history, you will act that out. But if you believe you come from greatness, that you truly are a black man, a woman from the Nile, you'll act that out too. And Dr. Ben was a pioneer in that, and cannot say enough good things about him in that regard. I didn't realize until listening to your program this morning that he has such a big impact on Africans in Jamaica.
Oh,
I didn't even know he'd been in Jamaica.
Oh, twice, and I'm telling you.
I find that very interesting.
Yes, and very outspoken, interestingly enough, because I remember the first time he came in 97, when we were talking just before he came in, he said, listen, there's something I need to talk about, but I want us to sit down and talk about it as a family, that is the African family. And that was his family's relationship, his father's relationship with the Emperor Haile Selassie. And he said, I need to get that out, but we need to talk to each other. And when he was delivering his lecture, the first thing he did was to get that out. And then he said, listen, you know, I have a situation because of my father's relationship, and here we are together as one family. Let us talk together and let us work together. And believe me, by just doing that, Dr. Ben had the audience eating out of his hand for the entire time by just laying that out there and saying, this is my problem, this is a relationship, the issue I'm having, and this is what I think. You know, so that became...
Well. Yeah, I think, too, and you haven't asked me this, maybe you don't want to hear this, but I'll say it anyway. I think that we can look at Dr. Ben as perhaps the last of those great men and women from that generation, or his generation. John Henry Clark is gone. Chancellor Williams is an ancestor. Ivan Van Sertima died prematurely. Ivan was only in his 70s. Dr. Ben was 97.
Mm-hmm.
The great Asa Hilliard. You have others who perhaps are not as well-known, people like Edward Scobie, George Simmons, who is a colleague and a co-worker with Dr. Ben. So Dr. Ben, I guess, represents, in my opinion, the last of that generation of African scholars who we begin to hear so much about during the 1970s and endured during the 1980s and 1990s. He hung on. You know, 97 years old, that's almost a century. That's a long time to be around.
But and so I hear you saying that
you're really a remarkable person, and I don't know if there'll be anybody like that again.
Well, and I hear you talk about being the last of that generation. Just looking back at Dr. Ben over the last few days, and I'm having this conversation with my husband. You know, there is, and maybe we are to take some responsibility for this, that there's an entire generation, because I was saying to my husband, let me just go back a bit, that, so I'm checking the social media to see what the response has been like in terms of Dr. Ben's passing and so on. And yes, there was some activity, not as much as I expected. And so I said to him, you know, a lot of young people on the social media, and it tells me then that in terms of the African family, there's an entire generation, probably two, or going up without the benefit of a knowledge of the work of Dr. Ben. How do you see this?
Well, I think each generation has to pave its own path. You know, you build on the generations that came before you. And I guess that's one reason I tend to shy away from this thing that people like myself and Ashok Kwesi and others, the baton has been passed to us. I see us, in a sense, as very, very different. You know, that we were very much influenced by people like Dr. Ben and me, you know, not only Dr. Ben, but John Henry Clark, the great John Henry Clark, who I love so much.
Yes.
And even more directly by Ivan Van Sertima. But I think it's a different generation. Now you got people talking about hidden colors. Now everything is digitized.
Yes.
So much people are influenced by YouTube, and that has good and bad qualities and aspects. But I think that each generation has to leave its own mark, has to build its own pyramid.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I think it remains to be seen, you know, what my generation, what its ultimate impact is going to be. Like, I'm very different. I'm a traveler. I just completed, you know, visiting 108 countries in the last 16 years. Nobody's ever done that before.
Mm-hmm.
To me, no African scholar, certainly in modern times, has traveled around the world as much as I have.
Yes.
You know, I've looked at black people in places like India. You know, there were branches of the Garvey movement in Australia. There was a black power movement. Nobody's ever really done that before.
True.
You know, Kwesi is in Kemet all the time. He's looking at the African roots of religion. you have different people doing different things. And certainly each generation is influenced and stands on the shoulders of the previous generation. But time does not stand still. This movement is fluid, mm-hmm. and it's dynamic, and it's moving on. And I just hope that people who are watching Hidden Colors and who will come after that mm-hmm. will acknowledge that it didn't start with them, that it's a continuum of knowledge, and they too will have the opportunity to leave their mark and to influence generations to come.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Wunuka Rashidi. I really do appreciate your taking the time to join us in this tribute to Dr. Yusuf Ben-Yohanan. Thank you so much, Dr. Rashidi.
Thank you, sister.
All right.
Bye-bye.
All right, Dr. Wunuka Rashidi there speaking about his own relationship with Dr. Ben.
Yefri Africa. Africa. Running Africa ni. Ahaya Jamaica. So what take kakase boso kadia? Ewo Ire FM.
You're inside of the Africa Forum, Running Africa, and its tribute to Dr. Ben-Yohanan, a celebration of the life of Dr. Ben. Dr. Ben was in Jamaica in 1997, then again in 1998 at the invitation of IRE FM. In 1997, he delivered our Black History Month lecture at the time, the public lecture at Coconut Grove Great House here. What we've done is gone back to that speech, collated just bits and pieces from that speech, because it was a long speech. Over an hour long, much more than an hour, and created a montage of the highlights, some of what Dr. Ben said here in Jamaica in 1997. Let's go.
I am going to speak to you not of what God tell me, because he never tell me anything. So when I speak to you, it's going to be from my knowledge or someone else's knowledge that I have copied from his particular book or something else. Or I have seen the document someplace at a certain place, and I've taken them primarily with photography and present them to you in writing. Many people look at me at that time very spitefully, and otherwise, including my grandmother. My grandmother could not understand how come my light-skinned mother brought this little imp to Puerto Rico. She used the exact word, she says, to her daughter one morning. I bothered her, obviously. And she said, "Wait, Judah, where you brought this imp for?" And she said, "My mother, I brought it because I got it." A woman, an African woman, is sacred. When you touch her, when you touch an African woman, you have touched a goddess. And if you don't want her, don't trouble with her. Leave her alone, she can find something better than you. I'm speaking to you, and I don't care who hear what I tell you, it is the truth. So let them hear it. If she doesn't like it, too good, too bad for her. If we don't like it, too bad for him. That is the thing. And another thing, we have to speak to each other. I am a Garveyite. My father represented Marcus Mosiah Garvey in Puerto Rico and the United States Virgin Islands, and was the leader of the movement, the chairman of the movement, from the day he got to the Virgin Islands to the day he died at 102 years old. And I'm going to still be a Garveyite. I'll do what I come and saw. Garvey's like a stool boy here in his native land. Here is the place where Garvey should have lied down with dignity, with respect, with honor. He spent his entire life towards the Jamaican people first and other people next. and his brothers and sisters in Jamaica treat him like a dog. I went to see for myself. Miss Blake took me this morning out to St. Anne's. I went to a little library and see a little ugly looking statue. Then I went down the street rather to his home and saw a little home down the hill just like when it was in the 1800s. And people live in it and it's still broken down. And then I went to a high school, symbolic of Garvey's name, heaven knows. For Jamaica to say that that is a national high school in its name, the name of Garvey, it is, I'm sorry that Nelson is gone. Nelson, if a house were built for Nelson now, it would be a palace. And Nelson was the worst good-for-nothing murderer that ever lived in the world. But that's what we are. We are very good replicas of our slave masters. Runs from Lake Tana down to Khartoum. The White Nile runs from Nyanza. I can't say that. I cannot call that Lake Elizabeth Fall or some damn fall like that, because Elizabeth have never had a fall in England, and she damn sure don't have one in Africa. To find a way to speak to each other. We differ with each other because of past information we got from the colonial master and mistresses, and they are not good enough for us. For instance, I can join up to the border of one African country in the railroad and can't go into the other because the railroad stopped there. And the reason it stopped there is when the colonial master was there, he built a road for himself and didn't go into the other country, because it wasn't his. But if it was his, it went in. And then we come with the same animosity against each other and continue. No, I say we got to find a way to speak to each other. The reason we don't speak to each other, we think we are better than each other. We either got a better program, a better body, or better something. And we're all a bunch of fools for thinking that way. What you call the Christian era, 1,000 is the best. And Homer, the first writer of Europe, the first, no other before him, is not until 833 when he wrote the Iliad and the Odyssey. In Egypt, the first foreigner to come there, and it's in Egypt is the first place that the European came. The Hyksos came there in 1165. That was before the last pyramid. Listen to this when you tell me some nonsense about Moses. Remember that the last pyramid, Egypt has 96 pyramids. Sudan have 44 pyramids. 44. Do you know that? The first pyramid was built in Egypt in the third dynasty by a man called Imhotep, a multi-Jew. Imhotep built it to bury his pharaoh, because all the other pharaohs before were built in a wood box. with nothing in, but in the ground. He built this with six layers of boxes, one smaller than the other, until it gets to the sixth. And they're still there in bad condition, the stone, but they're there. At a place called Saqqara. There was civilization in Uganda before Ethiopia, in Uganda before Sudan, in Uganda before Egypt. Read, go study. If you don't believe me, go with yourself, your body. Go to Uganda, check what Uganda got. And you will stop that nonsense unless you have the fact. Shut up. You have to have facts to talk. And what they tell you about Moses. Abraham wasn't born in a place called Ur in Chaldea, they tell us. And he wasn't born during this time. And if he wasn't born, how could Jews build a pyramid and the first Jew ain't born yet? A hungry woman and a hungry child needs protection from you, from me, from even her friend. And she is entitled to get food for that child at any cost.
Dr. Yusuf Ben Yochanan, as he is.
I want to speak to you, not of what God tell me, because he never tell me anything. So when I speak to you, it's going to be from my knowledge or someone else's knowledge that I have copied from his particular book or something else. Or I have seen the document someplace at a certain place and I've taken them primarily with photography and present them to you in writing.
The great grandmaster teacher. From his lecture in Jamaica in 1997, right here at the Coconut Grove Greenhouse, he was a guest of IRIE FM, our annual Black History Month public lecture at the time. Dr. Ben challenged us. I went to Egypt, my husband went to Egypt, and we made Egypt a study, and we kept going back and forward and back and forward to Egypt. And we managed in all that time to be cognizant, aware that this is our land. But more than that, our purpose, in Sankofing and taking the message back so that we can Africanize where we are, was made even clearer. Dr. Ben challenged us. In 1991, Dr. Ben challenged me personally. He said, when I asked him in an interview about the miseducation of the African, about the misinformation regarding Egypt, regarding Kemet, he said to me, I don't see you there digging. They are there digging. And he has said that to so many, and in so many lectures. He said, they are there in Egypt digging. Zawi Hawass is in Egypt digging. And all the Arabs and the French and the German are in Egypt digging. And he says, when I go to Egypt, I don't see black people digging for the truth. And so Dr. Ben engaged in a literary archaeology that afforded us the knowledge of ourselves. From the beginning of an hour where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountain of the moon, he took us to the papyrus of UNEFA. We're paying tribute to and we're celebrating Dr. Yusuf A.A. Ben Yochanan. Right here at this time, in this place, in this space.
Ye free Africa.
Africa.
Running African ye. Aha, Jamaica. So what take a kase boso kadia? Ewo Ire FM.
We're back with you inside of the Africa Forum, a mentor, a friend to the program, and a mentor of the program is Professor Leonard Jeffries. Professor Leonard Jeffries is joining us on the phone lines now. He himself in California for a public lecture, and we're standing. Okay, here he is. Professor Leonard Jeffries joining us on the phone lines. Dr. Jeffries, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us in this tribute and celebration of the life of Dr. Ben.
Well, you know, it's always a pleasure for me to join you and the family in Jamaica in any of these important activities that we have been together on over the years. And certainly this one is monumental, a chance to pay respects to a special spirit that moved among us. And I describe him as a gift that keeps on giving in terms of our dealing with the Nile Valley and the civilization of the ancients of Africa. So we mourn the loss of this great brother, but we celebrate the fact that he was able to be such a long-distance runner, to be able to leave his mark on history over this long haul. Most people don't realize that, like I do, that when I was born in 1937, after my first year, Dr. Ben took upon himself a mission in 1938 to go to Africa by himself in the Nile Valley and to try to claim it for African peoples. And so now at the dawn of my 80th birthday, 78 years old now, and Dr. Ben, all of my life, he has been working to give us this enormous achievement, our history, our deep roots, that has been so systematically kept away from us, as if we contributed nothing to history and civilization and high culture, when in point of fact, our gift has been civilization itself to the world. Mm-hmm. And nobody raised that higher than Dr. Yosef Benyakinen. So we're proud to have been at his side and at his feet and supporting him. And certainly at this time, we're now preparing this week a great celebration of this brother and his achievement.
Wow, thank you so much for that. Dr. Jeffries, you've had also a long personal relationship with Dr. Ben. Can we talk a little bit about that relationship?
Certainly. Dr. Ben was a difficult individual because he was on mission. And he wanted you to be on mission and have something meaningful in your life. And so he didn't tolerate folks that were not serious. And so once you were there, you were in his presence, and once you know about his work, you wanted to be a part of it. And he challenged you. And just as I heard you mention, he challenged you about digging in the Nile.
Yes.
And so that became a part of our process, not only going to the Nile Valley to understand and appreciate the culture, but to go with a purpose, to go not just on a tour, but to go with a mission. And we refer to it as a pilgrimage, that you were recovering the sacred roots of your people, and knowledge is power, and African knowledge is African power, and African knowledge of Nile Valley, it is the victory. Because so many people have claimed the greatness of the Nile, the systems of writing, the systems of philosophy, the systems of medicine, the systems of architecture, and systems of governance, and systems of spirituality, and the formation of leaders, and even this enormous economic development that the Nile experienced once it was able to harness the flow and overflow of the Nile Valley. He made sure that we saw more than just a touristic view, that he saw the rise of a global African family. And so we're indebted to him beyond belief. He was also he wanted to create tiger cubs like the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey.
Yes.
And so those of us that became part of his world, we became his tiger cubs, and we've continued his legacy. And he now can feel proudly that there's a series of digs in the Nile Valley by our people, and one of his tiger cubs could be considered Tony Browder.
Mm-hmm.
Because Tony Browder, a few years ago, collaborated with a Polish archaeologist who was digging, and he's taken upon himself that project, raising money and taking people to the Nile to dig, and he has discovered the tombs of a 25th dynasty nobleman, and he has taken several tourists each year. He has 70 to 100 people involved in the dig, and the Egyptian government, no matter who's in power, because you've had several changes in the Egyptian government, but both the sides that come to power respect what Tony Blair is doing, and he's doing it, carrying on the legacy of Dr. Ben.
Wow.
He named the project the ASIP Project, and it relates to respect for Glaucomum, who was the noble who was discovered, and it is also respecting the contributions made by Dr. Asa Hilliard, who was another of our great brothers inspired by the work of Dr. Ben and contributed significantly to the capturing of Nile Valley civilization for African peoples so that it can be part of our empowerment instead of our degradation.
Mm-hmm. We have named today, Dr. Jeffries, we have titled the program From the Beginning of the Nile Where God Happy Dwells to the Foothills of the Mountains of the Moon. And how relevant is this? Because this is something, I don't think I've ever had a conversation with Dr. Ben or heard him speak without mentioning this.
Yes, he wanted to make sure that we felt an African-centered view of the Nile and the history of the world, as opposed to the European-centered view, which had us looking at the Nile from the delta on the Mediterranean as the centerpiece of development. And he wanted us to look at the deep roots of the Nile that extend down into Africa, thousands of miles, to the Great Lakes region, which is in Uganda area, Central Africa. And he was clear to point out that the Nile Valley Africans developed traditions and ceremonies and rituals pointing to that southern origin. And so Happy is the name that the ancients of Kemet, that's the northern part of the Nile, and Nubia is the southern part, but Happy is the name that they used to refer to this great river system. And it's a phenomenal geological factor because it originates in the Great Lakes regions where the spiritual consciousness of God dwells, and it continues through the White Nile, which joins the Blue Nile in the Sudan, and then joins the Atbara coming down from the mountains of Ethiopia. And those three river systems become the Great Nile that moves on to the Delta area and has this magnificent overflow annually each year that takes the rich soil from inner Africa and deposits it along the banks of the Nile and allows for the production of several rich crops. And so that economic component became the foundation of this great civilization. And then because of the extensive geography, thousands of miles, and because of the overflow, which did damage to the existing structure, so you had to rebuild every year. And so you had to have a political system to manage this enormous economic phenomenon of the overflow. And then because it happened every year over the centuries and over the millennia, thousands of years, you created an understanding that this was a divine blessing, that the overflow of denial was attached to an understanding of it, was attached to the movement of the heavenly bodies.
Mm-hmm.
And when a certain set of stars were in the heavens at a certain particular point, that meant denial was going to begin to rise. And then that certain set of stars is in another position in the heaven, that meant that the Nile was going to overflow. And then after months of the overflow now fertilizing the soil along the banks, that same set of stars would be in another position in the heaven, and that meant you could plant your crop. And then after another period, there was the harvest, and those certain set of stars reflected when that harvest was going to occur. So it was reading the heavens and understanding what was happening on earth that Africans could see a divine order of the universe, and they could build their culture around this important phenomena. So it has nothing to do with the northern crater, the European world. It has everything to do with understanding the southern crater and the divine order that's in Mother Nature, and the divine order that can be seen and read in the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
So with this blessing from the heavens that is God-given, Africans were able to create a philosophy that laid before the world that there is a divine blessing in the human family. Because when the man and the woman, the husband and the wife, get together and there is a watering after intercourse, then there's a certain set of stars in the heaven. And then after a period of time, that activity of the man and the woman begins to produce the pregnancy, and then the certain set of stars are in another position of the heaven. And then after a 9-month period, the child emerges as the harvest, the human harvest of this divine process. So Africans are able to relate the divine order of the universe in terms of Mother Nature to the divine order involved in the mothering of the human family,
mm-hmm.
and the great structures, the literature, the philosophies, the rituals, the traditions, all centered around this fantastic phenomena.
Mm-hmm.
And so Dr. Benton was the one who said, we're not just going to marvel at the architecture or see the great structures and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to understand the deep understanding of the African family that laid the foundations for high culture and civilization.
And talking the African family, in terms of the African family, even today, the contemporary and modern African family, how important is Dr. Ben and the work of Dr. Ben to the African family? I know this is a question that is as abstract as ever, but take it as you understand it, Dr. Jeffries. How important is the work of Dr. Ben and Dr. Ben?
For me, I've spent the bulk of my adult life, I'm now 78, and since I was a teenager, I've been on this path. And so for the last 60 years, I've been back and forth to Africa. Most of us have been nurtured with misconceptions about Africa, and so that needs to be broken.
Yes.
I've been able to travel to Africa, the Caribbean, and Brazil over 100 times over the last 57 years. And so I've had that miseducation broken, and the strength and the trueness of black people has seriously been established. Now, a brother who was very important in leading our way in this direction was Dr. John Henry Clark.
Yes.
And it was interesting that Dr. Ben was passed from Ethiopia and a mother from the Caribbean, Puerto Rico, and being raised in St. Croix, Dr. Ben had this view of Pan-Africanism, of African peoples. However, the person who gave us the Pan-African perspective on the whole continent was his elder, Dr. John Henry Clark,
mm-hmm.
who's now celebrating. He has left us since 1999,
mm-hmm.
but he is now celebrating, and we are celebrating with him, his 100th birthday. He was born in 1915. And 1915 was an important era because white supremacy had triumphed all over the world. in Africa, and in the Americas, the triumph of whiteness was very clear, colonialism, domination of our people. But the seeds of a new day were planted with the birth of Dr. John Henry Clark, 1915, with the movement of a Marcus Garvey to come to America to begin the establishment of a linkage and the birth of the UNIA, Universal Negro Improvement Association, African Communities League. And so in 1916, Carter G. Woodson said we've got to deal with the miseducation of the Negro. So again, the seeds of the new day were being planted. 1917, a brother from Jamaica, Dudley Thompson, Ambassador Dudley Thompson, a big brother for me for so many years.
Yeah.
And he began his march, born in Panama of Jamaican parents, but destined to be one of those great Pan-Africanists serving the continent and African peoples everywhere. And then 1918 or so, Dr. Ben emerges. And so he takes on this mission of delivering this truth to us.
Mm-hmm.
So Dr. Ben and Dr. Clark become twin powers of light,
yes,
coming out of Harlem. Mm-hmm. They lived two blocks from each other. And in the middle of the two blocks was the Schomburg Center, an African Puerto Rican who came to New York and opened up this a way of looking at the world and giving his collection of books and materials that started this great center of research called the Schomburg. So you see this emergence of a new mindset, a new consciousness in the 1915, 1916, 1917, 1918. And so I always felt blessed because Dr. Clark said we need to understand that African history is world history, and we need to see the missing pages of the history of Africa as part of world history.
Mm-hmm.
So that we looked at the whole continent. But Dr. Ben says, yes, you need to have an African world perspective on the world. You need to look at the whole continent, but you can't see the deep thought, the key ideas and concepts unless you zero in, laser beam in, on the Nile Valley. So these two greats in New York gave us this foundation on which to build a new world.
Mm-hmm.
And then out of Jamaica come these two brothers, also Marcus Messiah Garvey, bringing a vision of Africa and working together with all peoples from different parts of the African world.
Mm-hmm.
And then,
do you think,
after World War II, when you had the Pan-African Conference in Manchester, England, you had the emergence of these seeds in unusual ways. Ambassador Dudley Thompson came there as a representative of the Royal Air Force, and he met the Pan-African giants, Padmore, C.M.R. James from Trinidad Tobago, W.E.B. Du Bois, and Paul Robeson from the U.S., and from Jamaica, other greats, and Ross McConnell from Guyana. So that 1945 coming together represented the birth of a new African world. And so from then on, we've seen the explosion of knowledge and information that has rewritten the history of the world and given us a sense of mission, purpose, and direction. Dr. Ben's at the centerpiece of all of that. And
yeah.
Dr. Clark, and of course, the Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, and brothers such as Dudley Thompson, and our sisters as well.
Right, and thank you so much to Dr. Jeffries for the work that you continue to do. We see the thread, we see the continuation, we see the dynamics as we look towards full liberation, but also full liberation through knowledge, through understanding, through knowing who we are. And knowing who we are, of course, we have to go there to Africa, whether we do that through the pages of the works of Dr. Ben or the pages of the work of Dr. Jeffries. Thank you so much, Dr. Leonard Jeffries. Really appreciate that. We're going to be speaking with Professor Small, so we'll talk some more about the plans for the funerals and the memorial and celebration.
That's right. He's,
with Dr.
he's
Small.
Taking the lead on that, and I'll be leaving this conference tomorrow to return to New York.
Right.
And we'll put the final plans together to honor this brother and to keep on honoring him. He's the gift that continues to give, and we'll keep on honoring his legacy and the legacy of the other greats. Thank you for all the work that you do.
And thank you so much, Dr. Leonard Jeffries. Thank you, Puff. Professor Leonard Jeffrey is there speaking about his own relationship with Dr. Ben, the legacy of Dr. Ben. How should we honor Dr. Ben? Should we talk to our children this morning about Dr. Ben? How many of us, when we go to Egypt and go to the pyramids, we travel with all the books by Dr. Ben because all the illustrations are there and the pictures are there and the photographs are there. And we don't need tour guides when we go. We don't need tour guides unless the tour guide is coming from ourselves, like Dr. Broda and like Dr. Ronuka Rashidi and those who are going now. Because if you know, you go with the Arab tour guides, you never get it. They claim everything. But we go, for those who go without the African Center and the Pan-African and the teachers from our community, we do go with the books of Dr. Ben and Dr. John Hendrik Clark and Ivan Van Sertima and John G. Jackson and Chancellor Williams. Teach ourselves through those works as we go on. We match everything back to the book. Yes, we do, as we celebrate Dr. Ben. From the beginning of a Nile where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moon, the title of the program this morning, in celebration and tribute to Grandmaster Teacher, Egyptologist, author, Kimeta physician, civil engineer, academic warrior, Dr. Yusuf A.A. Ben Yakalan. A quick break, when we come back, we speak with Professor Obati Shaka. A minute after 8 o'clock, thank you so much for joining us inside of the Africa Forum this morning. It's a celebration, it's a tribute to our now ancestor, Dr. Ben Yakalan. And I'll be going to the phone line to speak with Professor Obati Shaka. Just want to say thanks to all those of you who are on the social media. Thank you so much on the internet at irifm.net. We see you writing us from the continent of Europe. We see you from the UK. We see you from Asia. We see you from Africa. Thank you so much for writing in. We see you from the United States. So many from the United States. And of course, I'm right here in Jamaica and in the Caribbean. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Hopefully we'll get a chance this morning to read some of those messages and tributes coming in from all over the world as we pay tribute to Dr. Ben Yakalan. Standing by for Professor Obati Shaka. Inside the Africa Forum, we go through until 10 o'clock in this celebration of the life of Dr. Ben. We go now to the phone lines to Professor Obati Shaka. Thank you so much, Professor Obati Shaka, for joining us inside of this very special celebration of the life of Dr. Ben and tribute and honor to the man. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, glad to have a chance to talk about a great man.
All right, I'm very happy to talk to you again, as a matter of fact. We have named this program this morning, Professor Obati Shaka, From the Beginning of the Nile, Where God Happy Dwells, at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. I was just saying to Dr. Jeffries that we named it that because this is one of the quotes from the papyrus of UNEFA that Dr. Ben is always, always repeating. And just from that repetition, it has led us, many of us, to go in search of ourselves in Africa. Tell us about your own relationship with Dr. Ben.
Dr. Ben was somebody that, was a man of the people and spoke at both universities and the community and around the world. I met Dr. Ben in the early 70s, probably 70, 71, and had him at my house a number of times. He spoke at a program that a group called Pan-African People's Organization that I chair held called African Liberation Day, and we'd have him come and speak for that. And then I was chair of a group called the Pan-African Secretariat And we held a series of conferences called the State of the Race Conferences. A brother named Yemi Touré, who was a member of our group from Los Angeles, came up with that idea. And we had people like Chancellor Williams, John Henry Clark, Minister Louis Farrakhan, and Doc Ben. And so, you know, I had a chance to have him in my house a number of times and talk to him. And then when I was doing research on the political legacy of Malcolm X, I interviewed him on his relationship with Malcolm, and he gave me some information that no one else had that was based on his personal knowledge of Malcolm. And then, you know, we would have humorous interchanges because Dr. Ben was not only a master teacher, he was also a great entertainer.
Yes.
And so sometimes when he'd come in, I have to remind him that, Doc, stick to the subject. Because he'd like to talk about where heaven was.
Yes. So
he's talking about black women. And
yes.
he had a graphic description of that. And I agreed with that. But then,
yes.
Doc, you're here to talk about ancient Egypt, so I have to constantly say, Doc, stick to the subject. Doc, stick to the subject. And so when he'd come in, we two or three days, I'd bore down on him, and that he then would stick to the subject. So,
yes.
And he was also somebody who was challenging the writing of African people out of history. That was his major piece, and of course, ancient Kemet was his central focus. So he was a maverick, and he was someone who enjoyed taking on the white intellectual establishment.
Yes.
But he also enjoyed taking on any blacks that he had any questions about. So he was somebody that never bit his tongue. You know what I mean? He was,
and that's a true and
quite a guy.
Could you talk to us a little bit about that, Professor Obati Shaka, about the work he did in the universities and also the challenge that he faced from his own colleagues?
Yeah, he has a number of major works. The guy was prolific, close to 49 books and articles, among which are African Origins of the Major Western Religions, Black Man of the Nile, which he abridged and added more to, Black, and then was Black Man of the Nile and his family, a book, Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, but a host of others, big, big books, too. And of all his works, I think his greatest is African Origins of the Major Western Religions. And Ben had a religious orientation as a historian, which is proper because for African people, the spirit is central to everything we do. So this work is... All of his works are great because he's establishing the fact that what he preferred to call Sais, later was called Kemet, ancient Egypt, was black. And he was popularizing a detailed history of ancient Kemet, a very detailed history. But he was particularly stressing the African origin of this civilization, but his African Origins of the Major Western Religions, which was basically looking at Judaism, Islam, and Christianity, he was showing the African roots of those three religions, and I think that that particularly angered the intellectual establishment, along with, because basically he was taking on European, racist European scholarship that wrote Africans out of history based on Hegel, who's a German philosopher who said that Egypt was not a part of Africa, it was a part of the spirit of Asia, and then talked about how Africans south of the Sahara were savages, and then just said, let us dismiss them for they have accomplished nothing in history. And so John was going back to the old scholars, including the Greek scholars, to show that this was in fact a black civilization, an African civilization, and that Egypt was not in the Middle East, it was in Africa. And than showing the roots, drawn especially from George James' work, Stolen Legacy,
yes.
The roots of Western civilization in Africa. So, you know, it was profound. But this book, The African Origins of the Major Western Religions, is, of all of them, I think the most magnificent, but they're all great.
Yes. He, talking about his scholarship, he was also what we enjoy, a kind of a Walter Rodney lecturer, professor, teacher, doctor, because he took his knowledge to the streets.
Yeah, and he dedicated his book, The African Mother of Western Civilization, to the street corner orators, because, you know, in Harlem, people would get up on a ladder and speak. And that was something that Garvey did as well.
Yes.
And Ben was that type that was in the community speaking, speaking in churches, speaking on street corners, speaking in community organizations, as well as speaking in the teaching in the university. And Cornell was a place that was special for him. Unfortunately, Ben never got tenure as John Henry Clark did, I think in part because he was a rebel. It would be hard. You know, many institutions would have trouble dealing with somebody as independent as him. But he taught at the university level and at the community level. He was somebody that always gave freely of his time. He was also good at popularizing his thinking on radio and on television,
yes.
Gil Noble's show, for one, that
like
he spent a lot of time on. And then he was an advisor to Malcolm X. You know, he was one of the principal people that shaped the program for the Organization of Afro-American Unity, along with John Henry Clark.
But do you know, Doctor? Do you know, Professor Obati Shaka, that this is not a well-known fact about Dr. Ben, that he was an advisor to Malcolm X?
He was not only an advisor, he understood Malcolm's personal quirks. And I remember, because my book's the only one to point this out, but people that knew Malcolm in New York knew this, and so when I was doing the research, I interviewed Ben on his involvement in Malcolm's organization. Malcolm utilized John Henry Clark especially as his African advisor, and especially on current events in Africa, but also on African history, but also Doc Ben. And John Henry Clark gave the account where Malcolm was going to debate a major scholar on the Congo, and he needed information, and so he sent an advisor over, and John gave him a folder on Mark Twain's Soliloquies on the Congo. And John made the comment that Malcolm had one of the quickest minds. John considered him the most brilliant mind developed in the United States in the 20th century, and I would say most brilliant political, historical mind, and philosophical mind. And so then John said he went on TV and, you know, destroyed his opposition after absorbing this information in a very short period of time. Doc Ben talked about one of Malcolm's quirks, because, you know, it's typical, and Ben was a little older than Malcolm, and Doc Ben would, you know, take things down to earth. And so he said, well, you know, one of Malcolm's real weaknesses was he didn't listen to personal advice. He was a very good listener in public, but in private, it was very hard to get him to listen. And he gave the account that when Malcolm was going to court to challenge his, you know, who owned, to question who owned the house he lived in, which, you know, the nation gave to Malcolm, but Malcolm never put it in his own name. He said he trusted the messenger to take care of him and his family if anything happened to him. Which he later came to regret. Everyone knew, and Malcolm should have known, he was going to lose that case. So John said, we advised Malcolm, when you lose this case, keep your mouth shut. Don't come out criticizing the messenger. And Malcolm went in, lost the case, came out criticizing the messenger. So when I included this in the book, I got criticized by by some people for including it. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, no, this doesn't demean Malcolm. We all have weaknesses. We all have quirks. Mm-hmm. And an old lady told me once, tell the truth when you're dealing with your history.
Mm-hmm.
But that was the kind of thing with Doc Benn. But Doc Benn was a part of an intellectual team because Malcolm was able to delegate. You know, he might not have listened in private when it came to some personal advice. He was able to draw from the ideas of people who had some depth in many areas, and so he did not shape that program of the organization Afro-American Unity. It was a team of scholars, including John Oliver Killens and a number of others, heavyweights,
mm-hmm.
and that was a part of his strength, that he was able to tap into different sectors of the black community. So yeah, that was Doc Benn, and Doc mm-hmm. Benn would have to be one of Malcolm's favorites because Doc Benn was in your face. He'd just tell you straight up, this is the way it is. And,
yes.
And if Malcolm didn't like it, he was going to get it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
That was Doc Benn. Mm-hmm. Doc Benn would do that with anybody. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of advisor you need. Somebody that's telling you the truth, not what you want to hear.
Yes.
You know? So,
yes.
Yeah, that was Don. Doc Benn. Doc Benn was political as well as historical. In fact, all his writings were political
mm-hmm.
because they were basically trying to free the minds of African people worldwide from the legacies of slavery and the legacies of colonialism by going back to our great historical past.
He must have done this as so many intellectuals, academics, Pan-African, I'm talking about like yourself and so many others, do at great personal sacrifice. Dr. Benn.
Oh, yeah, because Doc Benn didn't have a regular source of income, so he'd be a lecturer and get paid and a speaker and make some money, but this was not easy. Of course, in the 70s and in the 60s, the cost of living was a lot lower, but it got higher. So, yeah, that was hard, and mm-hmm. he had over 35,000 books, which, by the way, he donated to the Nation of Islam.
Yes.
Rather than donate it to a white institution.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that could not have been easy. And then of course he was under constant attack, but he was somebody who was taking the Western intellectual establishment and putting them on trial. So Doc Benn, I don't think, ever felt any kind of personal attack. He was himself kind of immune to that.
Yeah.
Doc Benn was his own
mm-hmm.
one-man army, intellectually and politically, and just in terms of his gumption, his backbone. So,
yeah. Well, you gave us a term. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Professor.
He benefited from the rising consciousness that came out of civil rights and Black Power,
yeah.
and Black Panther movements, and so blacks were more receptive in this country and around the world to African independence movements. They were more receptive to his message, and it was a message tuned to prepare blacks to rule themselves today and tomorrow based on what we knew about the greatness we had achieved in the past. He was also a part of an intellectual team. Dr. Jacob Carruthers described this team as the scrapers, the people who went out and fought. And so John Jackson, John Henry Clark, the author of Stolen Legacy, George Staines, who
yes.
preceded them,
mm-hmm.
J.A. Rogers, and Chancellor Williams.
Mm-hmm.
Now, all of these provided a factual background, armed the masses of African people worldwide, but particularly armed black scholars with relevant information that they could then use to build on, and that would lead to the next generation of black scholars. John Henry Clark was really the bridge to the next generation because he was more the theoretical
mm-hmm.
historian.
Mm-hmm.
And Doc Benn was a factual historian, but also in-depth thinker. And again, I go back to his book, The African Origins of Major Western Religions, where mm-hmm. he really shows how African religions served as the basis both for ancient Kemet's history and religious thought, and then for Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, and going into that in depth. So he had a philosophical bent as well because of his religious orientation, but those guys were a team.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And it was an amazing thing. And most of them coming out of New York, you know.
Yes, yes. You know, so many responses on the social media this morning from listeners, students alike, and others alike, coming from all over the world on Dr. Ben. How should families this morning, because it's an opportune time and people must be thinking this, how should we honor Dr. Ben?
I think by having an appreciation for your history and culture and your ancient African past and your current history. And Doc Ben's specialty was in ancient Kemet. I remember talking to John Henry Clark in ancient Kemet. I remember talking to John Henry Clark, and he said, he said for Doc Ben, his main focus was ancient Egypt. And then John said, that's good. But he said, for me, my focus is Africa. And then the African relationship to the world. And so for Doc Ben, especially, the importance of ancient Kemet or ancient Egypt to African civilization. Sheikh Anta Diop said that you could not understand the history of Africa without understanding the history of ancient Kemet or ancient Egypt. He said, for Kemet is to Africa what Greece is to Western civilization. And then, of course, he knew that a good part of Greek civilization and ideas and philosophies came out of Africa, particularly out of Kemet, though not all.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
By no means not all. And so, you know, I think that understanding... you know, I think one of the things about John that was, Doc Ben, that was really important is that he placed an emphasis on applying the past to the present and the future.
Yeah.
So he made the information about the African past relevant mm-hmm. for today. And that's really the purpose of looking at your past. It's not just to be able to, you know the history, know the past, but it is also being able to apply it to change your conditions today and tomorrow. And I think he wanted to end whatever vestiges we have of inferiority complexes,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Feeling less than as a people. And so he wanted to invest us with information that would promote love. And so, you know, I think that having an appreciation of our history and of our culture and passing that on, that's a part of Doc Ben's legacy and a part of all these great giants.
Professor Obati Shaka, as usual, always blessed when we hear you talk. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking time out this morning to assist us in understanding a bit more about Dr. Ben and in helping us to pay tribute and to honor the man.
Yeah, great man. A giant has left us, but now he's in heaven with John Henry Clark and John Jackson and Chancellor Williams and all the rest. And John Henry Clark can see up there, so can Chancellor Williams, and I'm sure they're having some big discussions.
I can just imagine. All right, thank you so much, Pop. We'll talk to you later on in the week because we do have a lot to talk about. Thank you so much.
Okay.
All right.
Bye.
According to a great high priest of ancient Egypt by the name of Hunefer, H-U-N-E-F-E-R, he wrote a papyrus. It's known as the Papyrus of Hunefer, the paper of Hunefer. He said, we came from the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells, at the foothill of the mountain of the moon. The mountain of the moon, there are two places in Egypt, I mean in Africa, named Mountain Moon. One is between Ethiopia and Kenya and Tanganyika, called Kilimanjaro, means Mountain of the Moon. The other is in Uganda, Renzori. It also means Mountain of the Moon. So when you look at it, there's two bodies of water that make up the Nile here. The Nile came down as a body of water from Ethiopia called the Blue Nile. The White Nile is a body of water from Uganda,
Both of these bodies of water meet in Khartoum in Sudan. They continue from further north from the south, and they meet another body of water out of the Ethiopian Highland, and that's called the Atbara River. And in Atbara, Sudan, those other two bodies meet. Therefore, from then on to here and to the Mediterranean, which was called the Great Sea, that body of water, the Nile, has been one that played the highway for a major civilization that started in Central East Africa and reached its zenith in this land. The 18th dynasty would consider to be the one with the most action. However, I would have to say the first dynasty, in that that brought into effect all that happened after that. What happened is this southern man, the country was divided into two, the north and the south. This man in the south, Nama, a king, organized his other vassals, other small kings, against the man in the north to have a unity, a man called Scorpion. They met in a battle for unity. Either the south was going to control the north, or the north was going to control the south, and they met at a place called Memnefer, to the called Memphis. The war was fought there, and the men from the south, Nama, won. He took his concept of the deity, God, Ra, against the man who lost his concept of the deity, Amen. You would think that he would put Ra in front since he's the one that won, but no. He was wise. Psychologically, he said, no, I wouldn't change. He let the god of the north be the first to be mentioned, and thus he made one god out of the two, Amen, Ra. So the people in the north said, this must be a good man. He let our god be the first to be mentioned. Ptah was, in the mythology, the god who made gods, responsible for making gods.
The god of all gods.
The god of all gods. The idea came from his prime minister, who was also an architect. As a matter of fact, he was a multi-genius, the first one recorded in all of human history. You gotta consider we're talking about 2800 BC. This man called Imhotep, or for short, Imhotep. He didn't want his pharaoh to be buried like other pharaohs. He thought his pharaoh should be buried in a much more glorious state than the wood burial place that they had prior. So he decided, when looking around, I could use this material, it lasts forever. And thus he set a stone, limestone, and said, I'm going to build it out of this. But there were building burial places out of this wood in a square. So he decided, well, look, I'll just use a stone or stone, and the same procedure, and that will last. But when he was finished, he said, gee, it's going to last, but it looks like nothing. So he decided to put another layer on the top and recess them, set them back, and six of them set back, looked something like wet cake. They become steps, and thus the term step pyramid.
Elder Grand Master Teacher Dr. Ben there. Excerpts from his interview with Gil Noble.
The Africans didn't do it, it wouldn't be important. But since that had been said for no reason at all,
They wanted to satisfy themselves that although they didn't, they won it in history, that they did it. Now, since it is that the people whose ancestors did it could not say anything about it in the past, now is the time that they declare to the world whose legacy it is.
Now, 8:37, and as we started earlier with the offering, the Hotep the Nasut from our brother Kwame Pianke, we did tell you we're going to be telling you a little bit about that, but we have been getting from some of our listeners a request to play that again. It's not so much about playing again. We do have a second one that we are going to play, and we'll do that now for you. And if not today, then definitely we'll be revisiting this, probably linking, having a conversation with our brother Kwame himself, so that we can learn a little bit more about what we're hearing. But here we go, in the offering for Dr. Ben.
Hotep di Nasut, Hotep di Impu, di Tep Juef, Kanti Shenetcher, Emi Wat, Neb Tajesser, Peret Karu, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Shenetcher, Merhet, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wavik, Jedet, Pet, Kamat, Ta, Init Hapi. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Ma Karu. An offering that the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh, gives. An offering that Impu gives, and he who is atop the mountain gives. Foremost of the Netcher's booth in Emiwat, possessor of the sacred land. An invocation offering of cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, incense, oil, and all things good and pure that the sky gives, that the land creates, and that Hapi, the Nile, brings. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep di Nasut, Hotep di Impu, di Tep Juef, Kanti Shenetcher, Emi Wat, Neb Tajesser, Peret Karu, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Shenetcher, Merhet, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wavik, Jedet, Pet, Kamat, Ta, Init Hapi. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Maku. An offering that the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh, gives. An offering that Impu gives, and he who is atop the mountain gives. Foremost of the Netcher's booth in Emiwat, possessor of the sacred land. An invocation offering of cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, incense, oil, and all things good and pure that the sky gives, that the land creates, and that Hapi, the Nile, brings. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep di Nasut, Hotep di Impu, di Tep Juef, Kanti Shenetcher, Emi Wat, Neb Tajesser, Peret Karu, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Shenetcher, Merhet, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wavik, Jedet, Pet, Kamat, Ta, Init Hapi. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Ma Karu. An offering that the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh, gives. An offering that Impu gives, and he who is atop the mountain gives. Foremost of the Netcher's booth in Emiwat, possessor of the sacred land. An invocation offering of cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, incense, oil, and all things good and pure that the sky gives, that the land creates, and that Hapi, the Nile, brings. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep di Nasut, Hotep di Impu, di Tep Juef, Kanti Shenetcher, Emi Wat, Neb, Tajesser, Peret Karu, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Shenetcher, Merhet, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabek, Jedet, Pet, Kamat, Ta, Init, Hapi. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Makaru. An offering that the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh, gives. An offering that Impu gives, and he who is atop the mountain gives. Foremost of the Netcher's booth and Emiwat, possessor of the sacred land. An invocation offering of cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, incense, oil, and all things good and pure that the sky gives, that the land creates, and that Hapi, the Nile, brings. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. Hotep di Nasut, Hotep di Impu, di Tep Juef, Kanti Shenetcher, Emi Wat, Neb, Tajesser, Peret Karu, Kau, Apadu, Seshu, Menket, Shenetcher, Merhet, Ketnebet, Neferet, Wabek, Jedet, Pet, Kamat, Ta, Init, Hapi. NKN, Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, Amaki Makaru. Offering that the Nasut, also known as the Pharaoh, gives. An offering that Impu gives, and he who is atop the mountain gives. Foremost of the Netcher's booth in Emiwat, possessor of the sacred land. An invocation offering of cattle, fowl, alabaster, clothing, incense, oil, and all things good and pure that the sky gives, that the land creates, and that Hapi, the Nile, brings. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice. To the Ka of Dr. Yosef Ben Yakinen, the revered, true of voice.
How are you doing, Mr. Roger Haswell?
I'm good, good, good. Very good.
So good to have you back. Good. Yes. From Honduras. Yes. We are paying tribute this morning and celebrating the life of Dr. Ben. And I know that you are a student of Dr. Ben. You want to tell us a little bit about your own encounter or with his work, because I don't know if you met him personally.
Both. When he was here in Jamaica, when IFM held their
public lecture for Black History Month,
that was
1997.
When
you were actually here.
I was actually here. Yes. When I was very revolutionary at that time.
You still are. Yeah, I know you still are.
Yes, and
That was a very big turnout. It was a massive turnout to that lecture.
Yes, it
spilled over from the Coconut Grove Great House into the yard. Traffic was backed up in many directions.
And heard some of his lectures as well. Listen to them from time to time on YouTube when sometimes I need to stimulate my mind and those are some of my encounters with him.
With Dr. Ben. And we're celebrating his life today, just kind of looking back to go forward. And I know you've traveled widely, but I don't think you've been to Egypt yet, right?
Not yet. Maybe only in my imagination and vision.
To the continent, have you been?
Only in vision.
Because I know you were planning to be in Morocco a few weeks ago.
Yes.
Because you'd have been just next door to. What's happening in Egypt now is really such a disgrace, actually, in terms of the ongoing fighting and the destruction of the artifacts and the destruction of things that our ancestors built. Because those who didn't build them don't give two hoots. They don't care. They are destroying, as we see destruction to similar ancient artifacts being destroyed in Iraq, in Babylon, and
they don't care at all.
And many persons I know who want to travel, because people still do, like Dr. Anthony Boda, Dr. Wanuko Rashidi, and others do still take people on the tours, similar tours like what Dr. Ben used to carry people on.
Yes.
I don't know the extent to which those are happening now for Egypt, considering the climate.
Yes.
And how violent things are.
Yes, sometimes so much anarchy over there, you know. Mm.
It is, you know, let them fight.
Yeah.
Right. But the pyramids still stand.
Yes.
And the Sphinx, Abu Hilal, is still there.
Yes.
But they would have destroyed it too if they could.
If they got the chance, they would have. They started.
They started. Napoleon tried.
Yes. The nose.
Yes.
There.
Target practicing.
Yes.
Those built by our ancestors still stand. Another thing I like about Dr. Ben, you know, we titled the program this morning, From the Beginning of the Nile, Where God Happy Dwells at the Foothills of the Mountains of the Moon, is that he talks about that so often, so that you can't help but say, you know, wow, I'm going to have to go find out for myself what all of that is about, so that we do not have the focus that we had only on Kemet, and we're saying, this is the area, paying attention to the borders created by the Europeans, that we lose so much of ourselves if we focus on just that small area. Exactly. It's really all of Africa, but in terms of how civilization started.
Now along the Nile Valley.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Ben was very, very meticulous in giving all of the breakdowns in regards to all that happened, you know, in that zone at the time, you know, and its contribution to modern civilization.
Yeah. You know, you heard Dr. Obert E. Shaka saying that, and I'd ask him the question that people like Dr. Ben, like even Obert E. Shaka himself and so many others, Dr. Jeffries and so on, that when they go out to lecture, like when Dr. Ben came to Jamaica, and, you know, Professor Obert E. Shaka has been here too, is that they do that as almost like a labor of love, and they do it at so much personal sacrifice.
Yes, true.
You know, it is something that happens in the community, that we ourselves have to stand up and say, you know, we're going to have to deal with this differently.
It's such a pity that they get a lot of ridicule for doing things like this. I mean, a lot of people like to see them. Yes, we have the knowledge, and they should keep it along up in the...
Right, they should write journals, articles for journals, and get, tenure. But don't come down
to the level of the normal man.
Right.
You don't want that. We started Walter Rodney. They never want it.
And Dr. Ben spoke about that when he was here in 97. Yes. I don't remember. They talked about not... as a scholar, as an intellectual, he understood that he had a different job to do in terms of reaching our people, reaching members of the family. So he was on the street corners of New York, the street corners of Harlem, and so on, teaching. Mm. And we saw Walter Rodney doing a similar thing. Mm. But that takes a lot of commitment, a lot of dedication, because Dr. Ben had many children, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, something like in the teens.
Yes.
Yeah. He was married 3 times.
Okay.
Right. Mm. So he had many children, so you can imagine. I heard the folk singer, but he's a Pan-Africanist who marched with Dr. Martin Luther King, Harry Belafonte, saying that his greatest mistake, so his greatest regret in his life so far, is that he did not spend the kind of quality time that he should have with his children, and that he took it for granted that they knew, because he knew, because he was doing it, because he was living it, he was marching with Dr. King, he was organizing, he was everywhere. Mm-hmm. He took it for granted that they knew.
Yes.
And I think a lot of Pan-Africanists and a lot of African elders and African-centered elders and young people can learn something from that statement.
So true, so true. Mm. Very true.
How do you think we should honor Dr. Ben?
We continue his work. When we have the space and the time, we drop in some of his lectures and, you know, what he has to say and what he had to say, you know, and do our part.
And I know that you feel very strongly about that. Yeah, I agree with you.
Yes,
no, I know you.
Real,
I know you.
For real.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
I really would like to hear, you know, from time to time, you know,
more of Dr. Ben's.
Yes. Yeah, because it stimulate the mind, it liberate the mind.
True.
And you know, it give you a sense of belongingness here on earth. You know, so yeah.
Thank you so much, Mr. Roger Haspel, as we celebrate the life and pay tribute to and honor Dr. Ben. Give thanks. Give thanks, my brother. From the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moon, we honor Dr. Ben. We're going to be speaking with Professor Small in just a few moments, in just a few minutes. Professor James Small will be joining us on the phone lines as we continue to pay tribute to and honor Dr. Ben, celebrating the life. But the tributes are coming in, and from the black Jewish historians, the black Beta Israelites, they have posted a tribute to Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan, black Jewish historian of his people. It's entitled by Rabbi Shlomo B. Levy. He says, the Israelite community mourns the passing of our beloved elder, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan, 1918 to 2015. He was born in Ethiopia and raised in the village of Gondar, according to the customs of the African Jews in that region, who are known as Beta Israel. His father was a member of this community, and he was married after his grandfather, was named after his grandfather, Yochanan. In fact, his name is Hebrew and means Joseph. Reading from the tribute coming in from the Beta Israel community. It continues, he received a bar mitzvah and during his adolescence moved to the Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico before immigrating to the United States. His magnum opus, We the Black Jews, was the first major historical work written by us, about us, and primarily for us. As such, Dr. Ben, as he was affectionately known, was our scholar and our champion. Long before his reputation commanded attention on the international stage, he was embraced by Chief Rabbi W.A. Matthew, leader of the Commandment Keepers Ethiopia Hebrew Congregation in Harlem. As a Jew of Ethiopian birth, Dr. Ben dedicated a second volume of We the Black Jews to Rabbi Matthew. He was a frequent visitor to many black synagogues. In 1977, Dr. Ben accepted an honorary faculty position with the Israelite Rabbinical Academy at Beth Shalom Ethiopia Jew Hebrew Congregation in Brooklyn, New York. Dr. Ben maintains a close relationship with the black Jewish community throughout his life, and it continues. Dr. Ben's work expanded to explore the Egyptian origins of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. When asked about this shift in academic focus, Dr. Ben explained that he was attempting to put our identity as black Jews into its proper historical context as a people and religion that literally came out of Africa. A tribute from the Beta Israel community. Dr. Ben demonstrated that the Torah and archaeological evidence both supported the claim that all the Hebrews who settled the biblical land of Israel, including Moses, Aaron, Miriam, and Joshua, were born in Africa and raised in Egypt. Zipporah, it says, the wife of Moses, was born in Ethiopia like Dr. Ben. As black Jews, we have always been comfortable with acknowledging our ancient and modern connections with Africa. The greatest criticism and opposition that Dr. Ben faced came from those who attempted to deny this connection and remake Judaism into a white European creation. It is important to remember, as Dr. Ben so frequently emphasized, Judaism is not a race. Of course, that's coming from the Beta Israel community, the tribute to Dr. Ben coming from that community. All right. We do have more tributes here from the Nation of Islam, from the ABS, and from condolences to the family and friends of Dr. Ben from the Rastafari Nation here in Jamaica. That's a tribute coming in, a condolence message coming in from the Rastafari Nation. Thank you so much for sending that in. We go to the telephone lines now as we continue to celebrate the life and pay tribute to and honor Dr. Yosef Ben-Yochanan in this space, at this time, in this place. Professor James Small standing by. Good morning, Professor Small. Thank you so much for joining us in this tribute and celebration.
Good morning to Jamaica.
All right. Good to have you as usual. I was telling the younger ones about you here recently and about the work that you have done. And we're looking at Dr. Ben, and then we're looking at everybody surrounding Dr. Ben. And I was just saying, you know, I remember being in Ghana when the ancestors were coming in on the water, and I was in the and I was in the sea.
That was a fantastic moment in history.
Do you remember that you actually couldn't wait for the boats to come out, that you went into the sea?
Of course.
Yeah, so good to have you.
And I couldn't swim either.
So good to have you online. We still have that interview, by the way, of Professor Smalls in the water. All right, Professor Smalls, here we are celebrating the life of Dr. Ben. I know that you were a son, a close brother, a close friend, a colleague of Dr. Ben. How did you come to be so close to such a great man?
Well, you know, after Malcolm X died, at age 21, I became the minister over that mosque.
Yes.
And my first year, 67, Dr. Ben came to the mosque. And he came at my mosque to say, this religion ain't a nothing. This is not African. I had to throw him out of my mosque. And that scuffle that me and him had in 67.
Yes.
It made us the best of friends, and we never had a harsh word since that day.
Right. You know, Professor Small is resonating with me, because the first time he came to Jamaica and we invited him, we had also, before he spoke, we had an African fashion show. And so he took to the stage and he said, you know, I had to sit through that. That wasn't African. That was African material. The dresses are too short. So I can identify. Yes. All right. So you're saying since that time you've been very, very close. We've been talking about him all morning, and one of the things that I kept wondering throughout all the interviews that I've had since this morning is I know that we talk about, you know, his body of work and him pointing us to Africa and so on. Do you think he was disappointed at any time in the pace at which the African liberation was happening?
Yes, and we spoke about it sometimes. He felt that we spent too much time on trappings and rituals, and we didn't spend enough time on studying the literature from that Nile Valley that the ancestors left to help us reconstruct our families and reconstruct society. Those are the two things. He felt that you had to reconstruct the family in order to reconstruct the society, and that you needed to study how they did it in ancient Egypt in order to know how to do it now, since the ancient Egyptian Africans left us so much good records, you know.
Yes.
They left so much written records.
And so, as I was just saying to Professor Obati Shaka, so that how do we honor Dr. Ben against this background?
Is to study the works that he left us, over 44 books on the subject, to study his works and to put a lot of the things he gave us into practice. You know, to put the program, like I'm a member of the class that he founded over here.
Yes.
And that's an ancient Egyptian society of secrets on how to build good manhood. We need to practice and broaden our manhood building organization to keep our young men in schools, to keep them out of prison, to keep them away from crime, to teach them how to respect our women, to let them learn our past so that we can construct our future. That's the one thing. He never missed a meeting. You know, we were having a meeting this coming weekend.
Yes.
And he was to be present at that meeting as he's been every year.
Right.
He will be present now because the meeting will be his going away ceremony.
Uh-huh.
And
well,
so he was very, very strong that we must come up with leadership organizations that use our culture, use our history, use our mystery teachings to help us rebuild the family so that we can rebuild society for black people.
And as you talk about his going away ceremony, what can you tell us about the plans for that?
Right. The meeting won't be, the final meeting will be on Tuesday after 4 p.m. to set the actual date.
Yes.
But it will be either Friday or Saturday. And we know we will be doing it at the Abyssinia Baptist Church. So as soon as we run out of that meeting on Tuesday, we will call the air. And I will make sure you get a call as well.
Yes, thank you so much.
We're going to give him a traditional Pharaoh's ceremony, which is called the opening of the mouth ceremony, that you can see in the Book of the Dead.
Yes.
At this time, I'm the acting high priest of the order.
Yes.
So I will be performing, or I will at least be overseeing the ceremonies.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure we will be assisted by Reverend Calvin Butts, who is the senior pastor of Abyssinia Baptist Church, the Reverend Al Sharpton, Dr. Leonard Jeffries. They will all be partaking in the ceremony. The family will be there, but the family has given the ceremony part over to the class.
Mm-hmm.
And the class is the society that he formed over here. So for those who don't know who the craft is, we are the father of Freemasonry. So that should give a good sense of what the ceremony will be. When you look at the Book of the Dead, you will see a ceremony being performed on Osiris as he's laying.
Yeah.
And they have a little tool, the priest with the leopard skin on the shoulder, have a little tool in his hands. That's called the opening the mouth. And what you do in the ceremony, you symbolically open the mouth of the departed, which will then allow him to speak for himself.
Mm-hmm.
So after that ceremony is done, there will be reading some certain significant and specific texts that Dr. Ben has written, so that he will now be able to again speak for himself to the world.
True of voice. Wow, I'm just, you know, getting all kinds of goose pimples. So that, you know, will this ceremony be open to the public, people who want to travel?
Yes, ma'am. It will be open to certain parts of it. Won't be, but what I just explained to you will be.
Okay. All right, so for persons from Jamaica who are thinking of making it, I've had so many questions about when it is and, you know, how do they go and are there trips from Jamaica and so on.
As soon as we find out on Tuesday, we'll make the decision on Tuesday evening. We're just waiting for Dr. Leonard Jeffries to get back to the city.
Right.
He gets back on Tuesday morning.
Right, and he did mention that.
And then that meeting and one of our doc's sons won't be available until Tuesday afternoon. That's why we're waiting till Tuesday to make sure the family has full input and agree and approves of everything that we're doing. And then we can go forward.
And Dr. Ben had a really big family. All the children will be there?
And all the children will be coming, and some of them are already here.
Yes.
And more coming in. Mm-hmm. And then he has family that he adopted in Egypt, and some of them are coming. So we are waiting on them as well.
All right. Our condolences to the family, of course, from all of us here at IRFM. By the way, lots of condolences coming in, especially from the African community, also from persons within the academic community and so on, to be passed on to the family. For those who, let us wait until after Tuesday, then we'll have some more questions about the ceremony. Yes.
Okay, but the one thing I would want people to know, that we always thank the Caribbean for sending Dr. Ben. You know, even though he was born in Ethiopia, he was raised in Puerto Rico for a short while as a child, but he was really raised in St. Thomas, the Virgin Islands.
Yes.
And that's where he grew to manhood, so Thomas, the Virgin Islands.
Yes.
And that's where he grew to manhood, so we really thank the Caribbean. You sent us Gandhi, and then you sent us Dr. Ben.
There you go. And Dr. Ben's accent says it all, you know.
We listen
to him talk, and we know he is a Caribbean brother, you know. But really, really beautiful soul, Dr. Small. So in all, you'll be overseeing most of the ceremony for next week.
Yes, sir. I'll be the presiding priest from the class. Okay. So I will oversee the ceremony.
Mm-hmm. And I know our listeners heard you talk about the Fathers of Freemasonry just now. And so let me not leave that hanging because we're going to get questions coming in. Do you want to elaborate on that a little?
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. I'm also a Freemason. So I'm also in Prince Hall, Cornerstone 37 Van, Junior Lodge, under our Grand Lodge. The Freemasonry begins in ancient Egypt, contrary to the traditional story of England. And so it makes its way from Egypt into Palestine, and with the Knights Templars and the Knights Hospitallers during the Crusade, it makes its way to Europe, and then from Europe to the UK, and from the UK to the Americas. And so that body of knowledge, which teaches us how to build character, is an African body of knowledge, which we practice with permission from the ancient order that still exists in Egypt. They allowed Dr. Ben to establish an order over here in the West. And it is that order that will be performing the ceremony.
All right. And once again, this ceremony is, even though there's no date, you're looking at next week.
Yes, either Friday or Saturday.
All right,
yes.
So we can keep bear that in mind. But
we will let you know. We will make sure we give a call to Jamaica so you know as soon as we find out on Tuesday.
All right, please do. Any final words you want to leave, any parting words, even as we celebrate his life, even as we honor him?
The best way to celebrate him and to remember him is to study the literature that he left for us so that we may get the body of knowledge that he struggled so hard to give to his people, and to thank him for giving us back the Nile Valley civilization, which the whites had claimed as their own, until this one little man from the Caribbean came and pulled the cover off of everything. So we thank him for that, and we should study his works to see how much he really gave us.
All right. Thank you so much, Professor James Small. Thank you so much for
this.
And
we'll
keep in touch.
My dear.
All right. Professor James Small there, who will be the high priest at the ceremony of the opening of the mouth that will happen next week for Dr. Ben. We'll keep you informed. A little bit early in the program, but it's a very special program and a very special bottom line. After 97 moons, Dr. Yosef A.A. Ben-Yohanan, like the African called Ramses the Great, is entering into the afterlife, true of voice, Ma'a Keru. Dr. Ben now strides the ancestral realm. He began his journey into Ipet Aisut to join the great and loyal ancestors, March 19, 2015. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. Africa and the African diaspora are called to order, to stand, to pause for a moment, for a while, and be part of the mighty army that acknowledges the ushering of this great African spirit into Ipet Aisut. Fearless, irreverent, and revolutionary, Dr. Ben chose when and where he entered as an African, refusing to be relegated or indeed to see the African race relegated to the corridors of history, carrying the force of the race, the black race, providing the nexus around and within which we can and must unite. The bottom line is that Dr. Ben's legacy speaks volumes for African race consciousness and full understanding of Africa's place in history as the origin of all civilizations, religions, literatures, sciences, art. Dr. John Henrik Clark says of him, Dr. Ben made a mission of his life in looking at the corners and dimensions of his profession, generally neglected by other writers, historians, and teachers. The bottom line is that Dr. Ben's enormous body of work, sacrifice, loyalty, and love for Al-Kebilan and Al-Kebilan's Africa and Africans, his tireless efforts to illuminate, enlighten, and liberate our African minds away from paths of self-destruction and toward African liberation are etched in the annals of time and have a life and spirit of their own. Through painstaking and thorough research, braving academic classism, racism, and exclusion, Dr. Ben, through the papyrus of UNEFA, situated the African at the origin of the Nile, where the god Hapi dwells, at the foothills of the mountain of the moon. Dr. Ben made the study of Kemet, Ethiopia, Bakongo, Uganda, a sacred priesthood, and in this way allowed us to see the Egypt and Africa that was, and to envision the Egypt and Africa that still must be. The bottom line is that many of us, students of Africa and students of Dr. Ben, have come to define our purpose in the full liberation of Africa through the lens and the writings of our beloved elder, academic warrior, and revolutionary, Dr. Yesef Ben-Yohanan. The bottom line is that many of us students of Africa and students of Dr. Ben are braver, more confident, bolder in our knowledge and our interactions with the others, because we knew Dr. Ben, because we had read Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, Black Man of the Nile and His Family, The African Called Ramses the Great, The African Origins of Major Western Religions, etc. The bottom line is that Dr. Ben engendered in us a kind of radicalism and revolutionariness, yes, revolutionariness, that emboldened us in our determination to stand boldly as Africans, to declare, I am unapologetically African, to look bigotry and racism in the face and yell, hell no, to say to the preacher, show me evidence of Moses as president in ancient Kemet, and to the scientist, we know Imhotep. You can't confuse us with Asclepius or Hippocrates. And to the European Egyptologist, to boldly declare, Dr. Ben has found the first civilization developed around the Nile was at Bakongo in Uganda. The bottom line is that many of us students of Africa and students of Dr. Ben knew that the best way to stop an argument about ancient Egyptian civilization is to say, Dr. Ben said, and that's the end of the argument. We honor this great African, Black Man of the Nile, memory keeper. We honor this, our now ancestor, Dr. Ben, who we are certain must also pause for a while on his ancestral journeys into Ipet Isut, at the Nile, the beginning of the Nile, where the god Hapi dwells, at the foothills of the mountain of the moon. We stand with Africa. We stand with the elders. We pause for a while, for a moment, with Africa's liberators and Africa's creators, to honor this great spirit who made Africa and Egypt his life study, and who was unafraid to stand up and speak truth. Truth to power, whatever the cost. We honor Dr. Yesef A.A. Ben-Yohanan, now being received by Mwalimu Marcus Messiah Garvey, Dr. Sheikh Anta Diop, Dr. John Henry Clark, Malcolm X, Professor Ivan Van Sertima, Dr. Amos Wilson, Professor Chancellor Williams, Khalid Abdul Muhammad, Asa Hilliard, John G. Jackson, Jacob Caruthers, Gil Noble, Edward Blyden. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. In studio with me, Dr. Imhotep Rahu Kimet Ba. Now the Bakongo offering.
Ulu Yosef Benyo Kanan. Matonda Tatan Zambia Mpungu Tulendo. Enzituzo Tatan Zambia Mpungu Tulendo. Yenge Mwen Kembo Batatan Zambia by Mpungu Tulendo. Yenge, Yenge, Yenge. Matondo Tatan Zambi, Zain Kulu Yosef Benyo Kanan. Kia Basikama. Matondo Tatan Zambi, Zane Kukulu Yosef Ben Yokanan. Kuvazula Zabena Ethiopia. Zabena Kemet. Zabena Congo. Zabena Ndombe Al Kebulon. Enzituzu. Za Nenkulu Yosef Ben Yokanan. En Tumu Ndombe Bana Bael Kebulan. En Zituzu Za Nenkulu Yosef Ben Yokanan. En Tua Nkosi. En Tima Nkosi. En Tuma Kilombo. Nzazi Kidumu. Nzazi Kidumu. Nzazi Kidumu. Yosef Ben Yokanan. Nevunda Makandala Nguena. Matondo Yosef Ben Yokanan. Nsengele Embele. Matonde Kienu. Matondo Yenge. Nzituzu Nenkulu Yosef Ben Yokanan. Yenge, Yenge, Matondo.
Tributes continue to come in for Dr. Ben. From the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moons, this man was from there. All right, the tributes continue to come in for Dr. Ben. And Ankobia, not able to read to text back, but here is a tribute from Ankobia in England. She says, a reminder to us all that in the physical sense, our time is short. So as Africans, we have to make it a daily mission to fulfill our life purpose if we want those who come after us to live victoriously. Travel in peace, Dr. Ben, and may you be found, Ma'akiru, true of voice, and may your reception be a magnificent one, Ashe. Beautifully said, Ankobia. From Rasaibai and the Nyabingi group here in Jamaica, a tribute. It says, Dr. Ben, your ancestors welcome home a great son. His contribution in unearthing our glorious past will not be forgotten. The ABS celebrates the life of a great man and legendary scholar, Dr. Yosef Ben-Yochanan, December 31, 1918 to March 19, 2015. Dr. Yosef Ben-Yochanan was one of the world's most preeminent and prolific scholars of African history. He passed away early yesterday morning. That was the day after that this was released in a New York City at the stunning age of 97. So that was Friday, Thursday. It was only fitting that one of the most courageous and inspiring scholars of our time would live for nearly a century, paying personal witness to dramatic transformations in the lives of black people across the globe. But more than anyone, Dr. Ben, as he was affectionately called by generations of his devoted followers, knew that a world transformed was not a world complete. Black people might have lifted themselves from widespread subjugation, but they still suffered and were far from the glorious civilizations in Africa about which Dr. Ben taught millions of eager charges. One of his many specialities was the ancient civilization of Kemet in Egypt. He was one of the first true Egyptologists before that title had even come into vogue. It says that Dr. Ben was always controversial, was always a controversial figure because he had no interest in trying to placate white scholars or writers who were threatened by his claims about Africa, Europe, and the Middle East. Because generations of white orthodoxy had moved the Western world to accept as fact questionable scholarship about the preeminence of European rulers and thinkers, Dr. Ben was always willing to take down those Western myths one by one. Dr. Ben turned 97 on New Year's Eve and had plans to celebrate many more, but his friends took note of his diminishing appetite, though close colleagues like Dr. Jeffries and Professor Smalls were forced to go into the internet earlier this month to debunk rumors that he had already passed. At 3:30 a.m. on Thursday morning, Dr. Ben bid his farewell, Ashe. Amsterdam News editor Niambe Arinda says, he was one of the last great men of his era. He was a master teacher who just wanted to share our amazing African history. He was a man of the people. He was always amongst us, educating and sharing. Sitting with him was a gift of tremendous proportions. He was loved, and he loved his people. He was like a library of African history unto himself, as if a wing of one of the world's great research institutions had been poured into one brain and become ambulatory. Tributes are coming in for Dr. Ben. From the Nation of Islam, a tribute to Dr. Ben. On behalf of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan of the Nation of Islam, we, the student laborers and believers of Muhammad Mosque No. 7, New York City, offer our condolences and steadfast prayers for the family of our beloved brother and historian, Dr. Yosef Ben-Yochanan. This great black man of the Nile will be missed by all of us who were blessed to know him, live with him, serve with him, and be taught by him. Dr. Ben received all of us with respect and an open ear, yet he was always confident in what Allah God blessed him to know and teach. To his beloved sons and daughters, may Allah continue to comfort you and bring you ease of mind and spirit as we salute you and thank you for all the years of sacrifice of your father so that the black nation and the world would benefit from his vast contributions. From the Nation of Islam.
She didn't have me non-violent. A 9-pound baby don't come out non-violent. You hit me and start praying. You pray. Because it's not natural. Because I know this. You see, when King Uri of Ethiopia in 5100 established the concept of non-violence, he didn't say at any cost. When Akhenaten brought his cousin Semenkari and sit him on the throne of Egypt as co-regent in the 18th dynasty so that he could pay attention to non-violence, he didn't say at any cost. Not at the destruction of his people. When Rosa Parks got up in that bus, she had no PhD, no M anything, no B anything, but she had the integrity of an African woman that she was no longer going to sit down in the back of the bus and she was willing to die and take somebody with her. I know these are alien talks. These are alien thoughts because you believe that praying can change it. No way. Praying didn't change lynching. Because it still goes on. Instead of a Ku Klux Klan doing it, the government does it.
Yefri Africa. Africa. Running African ye. Ahaya Jamaica. So what take a kase boso kadia? Ewa Ire FM.
Out of the drum we come. As a people, out of the drum we come. Hey. Out of the drum we come. Oh. As a people, out of the drum we come. No. Oh. Out of the drum. Thank you.
everybody dance. Respect yourself. Out of the drum, we come. There's a people here. There's a people. The dance.
It's a dance of the elders.
Buddy Elder.
Out of a drum,
everybody,
he came.
Everybody dance. Respect yourself. The dance. Buddy Elder. Everybody.
All right. Nova ceremony of the opening of the mouth will be performed later on next week. In the meantime, understanding our role, understanding our responsibilities, understanding who we are in the great African family. Part of those who are ushering and standing by and watching as the elders and the priests participate in part of the ushering of the elder, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan, into the afterlife, into the IPET, ICERT, our elder.
Out of the drum we come.
Going off on the wings of the African community.
Out of the drum.
Spiritually. Sending him off on the wings of the Pan-African community. Sending him off on the wings of the Garveyites. We're pausing for a moment. We're stopping for a moment. And right after Dr. Ben transitioned, the big event was that eclipse. Yeah, we did have a solar eclipse the day after. We're putting it all together as we usher our elder. As we usher our elder, Professor, Grandmaster Teacher,
there's some people here.
Egyptologist, author, Kimeta physician, Dr. Yosef Ben Yochanan, out of the drums. And remember now that when we leave here, one of the things we're going to do to honor Dr. Ben is to ensure that we read his works, first of all. From the beginning of a Nile, where God happy dwells, at the foothills of the mountains of the moon.
As a people, out of the drum, we come.
For many of us, we learned so much from Dr. Ben.
Out of the drum we come.
He was our mentor, a guide, a teacher.
As a people, out of the drum we come. No. Out of the drum.
To those who continue the work, those who continue the legacy of Dr. Ben, more power to you. I want to say thanks to all those who participated in the program this morning. Thanks to my broadcast assistant, Shamara Preston. Thanks so much to Shane Clark, who worked into the wee hours of the morning. Want to say thanks to our brother, Kwame Pianke, who gave the Otep Dinasu offering. Thanks so much, my brother Kwame. Thanks so much to Dr. Wanuka Rashidi,
there's some people here.
Who took the time out, just returning from Vanuatu. He was there for the storm. Want to say thanks also, Professor Leonard Jeffries. Thanks so much, Professor Jeffries, on a lecture tour in California. Took the time out early this morning. They're 3 hours behind.
Everybody dance.
Thanks so much to Professor Obati Shaka, as usual. As usual, Professor Obati Shaka is always ready, always willing to participate and to assist. Thank you so much. Thank you so much to Professor James Smalls.
Out of the drum we go.
The acting high priest right now, who will be leading the performance.
As a people.
of the opening of the mouth ceremony for Dr. Ben later on next week, this week, Friday or Saturday. Keep that date.
Under the drum we come.
Thank you so much to our listeners on the 107s.
As a people.
On iRefm.net. Thank you so much for keeping the social media going and active. Thank you, my sister Ankobia in the UK. Thanks so much to Selector Princess. Thank you so much, Aldith Hong Kong, Irie Daughter, Michelle. Thank you so much.
Respect yourself.
Jabari Nkrumah, thank you so much, my brother. To all those on social media, we didn't get to the social media, but you understand. As we celebrate the life, Black Man of the Nile, Dr. Yosef Bunyakina. We're going out with the dance of the elders. Come on now, everybody, 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 everybody dance. Everybody dance. Gonna take it from the top again. Everybody dance as we usher the spirit. He's on his ancestral journey, Dr. Ben Yakanon, and we're pausing for a minute to be part of that dance in unison that ensures that he enters the afterlife through a voice, Ma'akeru.
As a people, out of the drum.
It's a dance of the elders.
We come. Hey. Out of the drum we come. Oh.
My name is Kabu, Kabu Ma'akeru. We'll see you next week. Out of a drum we come. Everybody, everybody dance.
Out of the drum. The dance of the elder. Everybody, everybody dance. Respect yourself. The dance of the elder. Everybody, everybody dance. Respect yourself. Out of the drum. Out of the drum. We come! There's a people here.
Shoshone is the spirit of the river. Open your hands, she's a sweet and steady giver. She'll turn your tears of sadness into gladness. Praises to Shoshone. Yeah, yeah, Shoshone is the spirit of the river. Open your hands, she's a sweet and steady giver. She'll turn your tears of sadness into gladness. Praises to Oshun. Yeah.
Creator, Fetal, yeah. Oludumare, Odumankoma, Enyame, Ama, Neter, all traditional African names for the one God. Abosun, Orisha, Loa, Neteru, aspects of the divine, Nsamanfo, Sheps, Egongo, ancestors on whose shoulders we stand. Black notes, libation, a spiritual offering, a prayer with props to God, to earth, with water, fire, air, breath of life of the creator, divine presence, wisdom, pow, connecting us ancestors, Queen Nzinga, Harriet Tubman, Sojourner Truth, Kwame Nkrumah, Patrice Lumumba, Malcolm X, Stephen Biko, connecting us to ancestors, struggles to progress, past to present, enlightenment to African cultural spiritual space, gracing the cosmos, the universe with aspects of the all, encompassing our entire being, singing in harmony with joy, in pleasure, beyond measure, in passion for life, voiced like the song of the river, flowing with the sensual grace of Oshun. Oshun, Heheru, Nana Esi, Oshun, representing the beautiful, the feminine features of life, lightly dancing to a timeless rhythm, in tune with the tone of a spiritual offering, a prayer with props to the highest, down to earth with water, fire, air, breath of life of the creator, divine presence, wisdom, power, like the nucleus, the core, black, sweet, black woman, energy, strength, black man, energy, complimenting black woman, energy, unifying, connecting us to ancestors, Martin Luther King, Queen T, Imhotep, Zumbi, David Walker, Nat Turner, Ida B. Wells, Marcus Garvey, Medgar Evers, Fannie Lou Hamer, Fred Hampton, George Jackson, Bob Marley, Peter Tosh, John Henry Clark, Fela, Anikulapo, Kuti, connecting us to ancestors, struggles to progress, past to present to future, transcending space and time, ancient to future, black notes, libation, and pie, a spiritual donation to creation, creatively opening the way from this day forward for divine